Welcome to another installment of the Pro Chess League here on chess.com. It's week three, and I'm delighted to be joined by none other than Grandmaster Dejan Boykov, all the way from Sofia. Hi, Dejan.
Hi, Laurence. Nice to be here with you.
Yeah, it's nice to be here. It's week three already, and the truth is that we've already been extremely fortunate to see the kind of chess we've seen thus far in the competition. We've had very dramatic matches. We've had huge upsets. I remember even last week, Dejan, when Flavio Perez beat Maxime Bachier-Legrav, outrated by over 500 points.
Amazing.
Amazing result. And this week, we should be in for another treat. And perhaps, Dejan, you can talk a bit about what the key matchups are this week.
Yes, I'm very, very pleased to announce that we are going to see for the first time the former world champion Ruslan Ponomariov, who is stepping in for Dublin Desperadoes. And this is going to be our top match today against the Cannes Blockbusters. You know that Cannes, they have a very strong squad. Unfortunately, Maxime Bachier-Legrav is not playing today. Oh, sorry, excuse me. No, he's not playing for this team, but Etienne Bakro is not here neither, and they have Mathieu Cornet, Mortas Kashgalev, Diamante de Lute, and Pierre Villegas today versus the Dublin Desperados teams. They have Ruslan Ponomariov, Sam Collins, Alex Lopez, and Conor O'Donnell. I'm pretty sure that Ruslan Ponomariov is a name that doesn't really need introduction, but he won the world championship back in 2001, if I recall correctly, after defeating his countryman Vasily Ivanchuk. Nowadays, Ruslan lives in Spain. As far as I know, he's married there, and he enjoys life. That's a good country to live in.
Yes.
For the Cannes Blockbusters, we have a freshly married couple, Mathieu Cornet and Diamante de Lute. And we have also a legendary Blitz player, Mortas Kashgalev. So this is going to be definitely very interesting match.
Very, very interesting match indeed. And you mentioned Ruslan Ponomariov. Not sure how much rapid chess I've seen Ruslan play in recent years. Of course, when he won the World Championships, the FIDE World Championships, it was a classical time control, so it was slow play chess. So it'll be really interesting to see Ruslan play in a more sort of rapid format, but he's of course going to be extremely strong in that. So the games are starting, Dejan. A number of games have already kicked off. Some are still waiting to get ready. I can see, for example, one game that has kicked off here is the game in one of our featured matches, which is between the Marseille Migraines,
yes,
and the Amsterdam Mosquitoes, and we have Baki 83, aka Etienne Bakro,
exactly,
playing against Grandmaster David Klein. So an all Grandmaster clash already, and we can see the board here. Dejan, what are your thoughts already on this kind of position? Looks wonderful for White, in my opinion.
Let me get there just a moment, Laurence. But before that, I just want to mention something. In this
yes.
match, we have something that we haven't seen before, I believe. There is another Bakro playing in the team.
Wow.
From Marseille. This is Alexander Bakro. And
oh.
I suspect that this is Etienne Sam.
Wow. Okay.
He's
fantastic.
Playing on board number four. Yes. And they have two other grandmasters, two other very strong blitz players, Yannick Gouzouli and Jules Mossard. While the Dutch team have two IMs, Quentin de Carmon and Miguel Admiral, plus Leonard Deck.
Yes.
This is their squad, and this is going to be an exciting match as well. So let me just get quickly into this position, and in the meanwhile, you can tell me your
yes.
thoughts about position, Laurence.
Perhaps. Yeah, well, I mean, Etienne with White, he's playing against a Leningrad variation of the Dutch defense, which is a very double-edged variation where Black moves his f-pawn on move one, and then fianchettos his bishop. But it's been a favorite of a number of top grandmasters. One that really comes to mind is David Anton from Spain, who has used the Leningrad Dutch successfully. And it offers, as well, it offers Black great chances to mix the game up, although of course White also has fantastic chances, so it's not a boring kind of opening which will lead to symmetrical structures or something like that.
Right. Well, what I see at the moment is that Black's pawn structure is no longer that symmetrical anymore, right. Anyway. And my feeling is that he's already in trouble, to be honest with you, even though he has the bishop pair. And the bishop on g7 is extremely strong in positions like that, but I don't really see how is he going to defend the pawns on c5 and on a5 on the long run. In fact, right now, White already has one idea, knight e3 and knight c5 to take it, besides queen c5 directly, or he can jump with this knight further on c6, and that might be even better.
Yeah, knight c6 is a nasty jump, actually, because let's say knight c6 in this position after knight e8, if bishop takes, pawn takes, suddenly you open up this file for the rook, and you create a monster past pawn, and also this bishop suddenly becomes alive along the h1 a8 diagonal. So this position already looks optically close to losing, in my opinion, for black.
Yes, optically. This is a very good expression.
It's an important word, yeah.
Yes. But yeah, we know that in rapid chess, let us remind to the viewers that the time control of this of these matches is 15 minutes and 2 seconds per move. So it's somewhere in between the blitz and the rapid. Most people would call it blitz. And definitely we will have a lot of action. So we are about to see how David Klein is going to defend this one. He is now sending his knight to d6, obviously, and he opens the road for the bishop. I think this is a very good idea.
Yeah, it's a good idea. The question is it enough? Because already knight c6 looks as though even after an exchange and knight d6, queen takes c5 might be playable, but even just, I don't know, some calm move like rook d3 protecting some things, queen. Yeah, I mean, it just feels like white is first, even if you sacrifice the exchange on a1. Yep. So a variation like knight c6, bishop takes, pawn takes, and then following it, he played knight d7, interesting, and knight a4. So this is the exchange sacrifice, exactly.
That's
what
the
I was talking about. Yeah, exactly.
That's the idea. He wasn't forced to sacrifice the exchange. He could have taken on d7 followed by rook b1 followed by knight a4 and knight c5.
Mm-hmm.
But I guess that he figured out that knight e6 is coming and it's going to be a little bit unpleasant for him. A very solid game. Very solid approach. Now he's taking the pawn on c5,
right,
in between move after bishop a1. I think he is going to grab that pawn first, and only after that he's going to take on a1.
Yeah, it looks already very difficult for David Klein. And for those of you who are perhaps joining us for the first time, and this is the first week you're looking at the Pro Chess League, this is a global online league with over 150 grandmasters competing, so it's the biggest league of its kind. And just so you can get an idea of just how wide spread this league is, it really is global. There are a whole host of different divisions from Asia to the west coast of America, and we are covering the central division, which is, as you can see on the map here, the green dots, so that's Western Europe and Western Africa. And teams from major cities, London, Amsterdam, and the like, all competing. So it's a brilliant concept. And for me, Dejan, definitely the future of chess online, and for the big money prizes, because you can bring so many together via the platform. So
exactly.
Absolutely brilliant stuff. Okay, so going back to the game very quickly, whilst we wait really for Ponomariov versus Mathieu Cornet, which is going to be possibly game of the round, actually, French champion versus former world champion. We have this position on the board, queen c7, David Klein. He's kind of holding in there, but knight e6 wins the exchange back already. Knight takes f8, rook takes f8, and then after a move like, we have to be a bit precise here, but you know, d6 might be a a really important move. So knight takes f8, rook takes f8, d6. The point being, if e takes d6, rook takes d6, and there's a lot of pressure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if queen takes e2, I've got the zwischenzug, the in-between move, rook to e1, and then I'll take on e7, which will be winning immediately. So I expect Etienne to take on f8. I don't see any reason to keep the knight on e6 for the moment. I think winning the exchange and playing d6. But the story isn't over. The king can come to g7, protect the knight, and perhaps, you know, give some chances to hold.
Yeah, well, the problem is that most likely black is also losing the pawn on the a file. So say after knight f8, even if you don't play d6, if you do some normal solid move with d3 and then you go rook d4, rook a4 and you start grabbing the pawns, there is no way that black defends though those pawns. So it's not yet over for black, but his defense is definitely very, very tough.
Yes, I would agree with that. Let's go to another game. Why not? You mentioned before that we've got a number of matches, and you mentioned Diamante. Let's have a quick look at Diamante's game. She's always fun to watch. She's playing here. This is one of our key matches. This is Cannes versus the Cannes Blockbusters versus the Dublin Desperadoes. With Diamante playing against international master Astana, who I can tell you is one of the best bullet players certainly I've ever played against. He's an unbelievable bullet player.
Have you played him?
I've played him online in bullet. Yeah, and online in bullet, that's 1 minute chess. And he has crushed me from time to time. Actually, more than time to time. He's crushed me on a regular basis. So he's a difficult opponent. And his position at the moment against Diamante is,
it's like he's simply up a pawn at the moment.
He's up a pawn. Knight takes knight will be met probably by...
No, sorry, Lawrence. No, he's not up a pawn. I
miscalculated the pawn. But even after knight takes knight, knight takes knight here, you have to feel like he's got a good position because he's hitting the bishop, he's hitting the pawn. And if you ever take here and f takes, you allow a lot of pressure down here on f2. So, but
the most important thing is that on queen h5, black can play e4,
right,
closing the bishop.
Exactly.
In attacking a bunch of stuff, the bishop on d3, the rook on e1, everything is going to be under attack. The pawn on f2 that you already mentioned, yes.
Precisely.
So maybe Diamante has to insert c5 move to block this bishop, but I have the feeling that it would be better if she can try to take the pawn on d5.
Yeah, very possibly. But very, very tricky position. Very, very tricky. I believe Ruslan has yet to start his game. He'll be playing against Mathieu Cornet shortly, I believe, but their game has yet to start unless I'm missing something. Perhaps you can let me know, chat, if I am missing a game here, because this is a kind of critical game, but I don't see that game, actually.
I don't see it neither at the moment.
Yeah.
I should add also another interesting game that we have a look at while we are waiting for Ruslan to show himself. There is Georg Meyer playing with the black piece against IM Play Dead. Georg Meyer, one of the best players, blitz players that I have seen.
Ah,
yes.
Hold on a second. I've been told it's below the Gibraltar gap. So we've actually got it. So let's go there, actually. Oh, my goodness. We've missed a whole bunch of stuff, but we'll get straight there so we don't miss the crucial part of the game.
This
is, yeah, the games were hidden behind everything.
Oh,
so
yeah, yeah, it was there.
That was unfortunate. Ruslan Ponomariov playing against Grandmaster Tokras, aka Matthew Cornet. This is the position. It was a Sicilian defense, Kalashnikov variation. Very interesting variation. And here, let's do a quick count. Material is equal.
I don't know if you know that, Lawrence, but Matthew wrote a book on the Kalashnikov, so he's definitely a specialist of the line. And,
okay.
So
I didn't know that.
This is his pet opening, yes.
Right. Fantastic. Okay. What do you make of this position?
Well, it looks like that everything disappears at the moment, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, black can take on b5. He can then take again.
Well, first take on f4, then on b5.
Yeah, if you take on f4, I was wondering. Yeah, so take on f4 first, and then take on b5. But e4 is his idea to go rook f4?
No, if rook f4, there is knight e to b5, and on ab5.
Ah, knight e2 check. Oh, that's nice. Let's show that on the board. So if rook takes f4, black would play knight takes b5, a takes b5, and then knight e2 check, which would fork the king and rook. So that would be a nasty check. So that's why Ruslan played knight c3. But black should have no problems here.
At least. He's winning a pawn at the moment he wants.
Can we not go g5, right? What's wrong with g5? Just protecting that guy.
Nothing wrong.
Looks like a good move. Gives the king space to come up from the back rank. So there's no... It looks like a long way away, but always good to have space for your king.
Yep.
And...
By the way, there is another version of the trick that we have just mentioned.
Okay.
If, for example, in this situation, white captures, if it is him to move and he captures on f4, there might be the idea of knight b5, a b5, rook c3, followed by knight e to check.
Beautiful. Okay, yes. So I'll try and... So if, let's say, takes here, so we'll go knight b5, a b5, so I can't execute the moves on the board, but knight takes bishop, pawn takes knight, and then rook takes pawn on f4, black has got the beautiful rook takes c3, and then if pawn takes rook, knight into e2 check. But there is an intermediate move there. White would have rook takes d4 intermediate, which would lead to what looks like a drawish endgame. So I like g5 here. That, for me, just looks so natural, just to protect the pawn and... Right? Protect the pawn.
So stick to the pawn.
Keep a pawn. Yeah. A pawn is a pawn, as they say. A pawn is a pawn. Very important maxim there. Keep your pawns. Why not? So I don't know. Yeah, he played it, g5, after some time. Yeah. Okay, rook d1.
Only move, I think, and that was the move most likely which worried Matthew a bit. But now I think he's going to take on b5 and go rook b8. Or rook c2, depending on the circumstances. I'm not sure which of the two is better, but my guess would be knight e to b5.
Wow, he played knight ac6.
Ooh.
Okay, that's a curious move. So he's just saying, actually, I don't want to give white any passed pawn at all on the queen side. I'm going to keep things solid, and still I like this move. I think black is a bit better. Not
up
easy to win. Yeah.
Up a pawn, right. Well, now 94. There are some problems. 96, 95 threats. And...
Okay, but...
But that shouldn't be too horrible, but still.
h6, protecting g5, knight d6, and rook. I can even go rook f8 if I want to go really passive. Is that, or rook c7? Is that such a big problem?
Rook c7, more to the point, yes, yeah. Indeed. One thing I want to remind the to the viewers, those who are here on chess.tv, on chess.com. Guys, we would appreciate if you ask questions and if you participate into the show. Anything you want, just ask. Those of you who are most active and give the most interesting suggestions, recommendations, and ask the most interesting questions, one of you will be awarded one month diamond membership.
Yes.
So you can test the services of chess.com. Don't be shy. Speak up your mind.
Absolutely. So keep your questions coming on the chess.com TV, and one of you will be lucky enough to win 1 month diamond membership, which is a very nice deal indeed. So what else have we got? No results just yet, I believe. Yeah, and h6 was played by Mathieu Cornette. And knight d6 as expected, probably rook c7, but he will look at rook f8 as well. Rook b8, aha. Now this is another interesting try. So he's giving up this pawn with check, because then king g7, you'd have to move the knight back, and then maybe knight takes. Feels like, yeah, something went a bit wrong, didn't it, for
no,
black?
No, you know, was the trick, maybe he's trying to trick him. After knight f7, checking g7, knight d6, there is the move rook d8. Now give me the knight. If you move away the knight, there will be discovery check with the knight from d4 to f3, and the rook on d1 is gone.
Uh-huh. And if knight f5 check there?
If knight f5, I take it.
You take it. My rook is defended. Beautiful.
Yes.
And that finally, is a trick.
And if you take on c6, this doesn't stop the problem, because I take rook takes d6. Give me again the discovery check idea.
Wonderful.
And give me a bishop at the same time on
beautiful.
c6. That's a devilish trap.
That's a really beautiful trap. So it all, knight takes pawn, king g7. Let's do this. So knight takes pawn, knight takes f7, king g7. The knight comes back to d6, rook to d8, and basically white cannot stop the discovered move of this knight, which would win the rook. So, fantastic move by Mathieu Cornette. Brilliant move.
Brilliant, yes. Especially in these low time controls, you should be always going for tricks like that, because you never know, there is a very good chance that the opponent misses them, no matter how strong he is. The time is very limited, very short, and we will see. Maybe Ponomariov is going to miss it, maybe not. Maybe he's going to see something deeper than that. We never know.
You never know. It's Ruslan Ponomariov. Okay. Yeah, brilliant stuff. All right. So let's see. Let's quickly go back to the Baki 83 game. This mm-hmm. is Etienne Bakro versus David Klein. And we have an ending, Dejan. And
so the pawns disappeared, as we were thinking about.
Yeah, and white has got an extra pawn, but black does have a very nice defensive piece, the knight, which is always an annoying piece, especially when it comes to d6, like it just has. Mm-hmm. Winning this position is not easy at all. King e5 was an idea there. Okay, h6.
The main problem for white is that the color of the bishop that he has is not matching the color of the h8 square, so he is not really very happy with his h pawn. Mm-hmm. In case that the other pawns are treated, the h pawn, even if black sacrifices the knight, will be theoretically draw position. And even though Etienne is going to torture his opponent till the end of the world, I have the feeling that this should end in a draw. What about you?
Well, I don't know now. The rook has come to e6. He can prize open with h5, win h6. I mean, even h5 here.
Yeah, h5 now is nasty.
Yeah,
he shouldn't have allowed this one. h5, he had to play h5 himself.
Yeah, he had to fix that structure. Yeah, rook c7 was a big mistake on move 47. He has to play h5. And now it's probably quite simple for Etienne, because he just wins h6, he wins h5, and with two extra pawns, really it's just a matter of technique.
That's another thing, yes. So, most likely, most likely I'll be predicting very badly.
Well, okay. Okay, let's go back to the Ponomariov game. Wow. Okay, so what happened? He played knight takes f7, and knight takes h6, a beautiful shot. Completely missed this. The idea is that if king takes knight, bishop takes knight on c6, the knight recaptures, and then rook d6 check, hitting the king and the knight. Even that would still be a draw because b2 is falling. But now Matthew is trying to calculate if there's some way to take advantage of this.
But he can check on b5 as well, but then he has to reckon with knight f5 check or the simple capture on b5. So he just took, yes. Okay, so bishop c6.
This looks like a draw now. Ah, rook d8!
The familiar trick.
Oh, and now rook e1. Okay, cute little
That was...
This is nice.
That was familiar counter trick, yes. Rook on e6 check now in case of knight c6. So Mathieu will have to take and go for the b pawn, but in a worse version than before, because the white king is going to go up after rook d1 check and rook d2 check.
Yeah. Should still be a draw, I think.
Should still be a draw, but this was extremely witty by both players.
Yes.
Extremely nice.
So rook e6 check, king h5. And rook c6, and now you have to go rook d1, king to f2, rook d2 check, king f3, will almost certainly be played. And rook takes b2, and, well, it just should be a draw. Many ways to draw. g4 check is probably a good way, because if king h4, rook h6 is mate, so you have to take en passant. And after h takes g3, rook b3 check, king g2, rook b4. I can still lose. This is a much better way, right? But it's probably just going to be perpetual now on the king.
Yeah, just perpetual. The king cannot go up because he is losing the pawn. So this is how the game will...
Yeah, this is how it will end. Yeah, that's a draw.
All right. Fair fight. A lot of excitement.
Draw.
Yes, excellent game, I would say.
Okay, let's go back to Baki 83, a.k.a. Etienne Bacquerot.
Already three pawns up.
Yeah, this is just simple for somebody of Etienne's class. Just the move g4 followed by rook g6 is good enough. And now f3 is good. Rook g6 also. And h6. He wants some stalemate trick, but there just is none. The king always comes to e8, so he can resign now with a clear conscience, and he will.
Yep, and we can see already there are some results. Marseille most likely are winning this match because they are also winning this game. So it's going to be 3-0 against Amsterdam Mosquitoes.
Wow, big result.
A tough match.
Yeah, it's a big result. And we can see the Reykjavik Puffins, some of the fans' favorites. All of you guys following the Protest League will have almost certainly seen the video of
Bjorn screaming
when he saved the match. Beautiful video, really taking pride in playing for the Reykjavik Puffins. They beat the Abuja Rockstars 3-1, no problem for them. And so far in the London Lions versus Stockholm Snowballs, no results yet. So that's a match we have to keep an eye on. And
A couple of other matches that are quite interesting, actually, I need to mention. We have the London Lions playing the Stockholm Snowballs. The London Lions, young Lions, all of them, IMs, James Adair. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing his name
James
correctly.
Adair, yes.
He's my teammate in White Rose, by the way.
Oh, okay.
We have young Fan Zhul and Daniel Fernandez, and I don't know the fourth player, Ravi Haria.
Yes.
Probably know him.
I know him, yes. He's an up-and-coming youngster already.
Youngster as well, okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. So all of them young players. We have the experienced squad on the other side. Georg Meyer, Evgeny Agres, Andre Diamant, and Ina Agrest. So all of them grandmasters except for Ina, who is WIM. And that would be an interesting match. Another match, two more matches to mention. Another London team London Towers. They are playing the Lagos Leatherbacks. It's very good to have African teams here, and I really enjoy seeing those people playing, and which once again clearly shows that the future of chess is in the internet. We can unite all the continents easily, and we can see all the people playing here, all of us. Reykjavik Puffins, you already mentioned them?
Yeah, the Reykjavik Puffins, they've already finished their first round game, so they're waiting. What we can see on the board actually here, Dejan, is the game between Yang Fanzhou and GM Esterga from the Stockholm Snowballs. And it looks as though Black is doing extremely well. This bishop on b2 is kind of not really in the action here. And this knight has got wonderful outposts, especially on c4. And these rooks are doing a good job. But maybe White is just holding enough here. What do you think?
I have the impression he shouldn't be holding this. So one plan to think about is to triple the heavy pieces on the c-file, jump knight c4, eventually try to capture on e3 on b2, and then penetrate with a rook on c3, c2.
Yes, this is very strong. And rook down to c3. Yes, this feels like... It doesn't feel like White should hold, right, in this position. It just feels... See, like his attack is too slow. He has to do something. I mean, maybe now you just go g5 to try and play g6. But
yeah, but that's a thing that you can, Black can easily stop. They take with the f pawn, and after that they go h6 and they're blocking the files, and on the top of that they're going to get the f5 square available for the knight. Actually, if this is played, Black can consider shifting his pieces on the other file, on the half-open f-file, and winning the game there.
Yes. Also very strong. Yeah, so, yeah, this looks very bad for Yang Fang. Okay, so Yang Fang is playing white. We also have IM Play Dead, who I believe is James Adair, international master. Actually, I believe he has... I believe he has all of his grandmaster norms actually, but just needs to make the rating. So I think James is going to be a grandmaster very, very soon. Playing against Georg Meyer, who everybody knows, especially if you're a chess.com active player. He plays in every title Tuesday. He's won a bunch of them. Rated 2654, an extremely solid grandmaster. And he loves playing the French defense like he did today. Struck because of the structures. He likes solid structures, pawn structures.
And he likes to trade on e4 as well.
Yeah, exactly. He takes on e4, the Rubinstein variation. Yeah. And today he has got a position where, you know, if I had to take somebody two bishops, I take Black here. King is very exposed. Pressure here. Weaknesses here. Yeah, I mean, for me, Black is better, Dejan.
Yeah, I think so too.
It's just a case of how best to increase the pressure. I don't know. You can think about expanding with b5 and b4 even to weaken this square.
Somehow, he needs to bypass this knight on g4. It's a very strong piece. Mm. So maybe moving the rook somewhere. But if he moves the rook away, there is a problem with the e6 square. There might be bishop e6 ideas, yes, or knight e6 ideas. He has to be careful.
Even just coming behind here with the queen, just to add some pressure down here, might be an idea. But I've just got to be careful about one weakness in my position. This pawn on h6. And make sure that I don't fall for some f5 trick in the future, but it feels like Black is completely solid.
Yeah, on g5 there'll be bishop. On f5 there'll be
bishop g5. Right? Yeah, that's true. So,
Just don't go queen d8 because there is knight e6 trick at the moment. Don't go there.
So king g8 was played and bishop f3 by James Adair. Okay, so yeah, bishop g7. Yeah, this is all very
Okay, so I think I know what he's trying to do. He just moved away the king from the possible tricks knight e6, and now he would like to go queen e7, queen h4, move away the rook and attack on f4, and go for direct attack on the king side with the two bishops. Is he good enough to do so? Does he have the time? Because white can shift his pieces on the king side, queen g2 and rook g3 as well. In any case, it's getting very exciting here. Let's stay on this one.
Yeah, well, we only have three remaining games of this round. Just a quick update of the scores. The Apeldoorn Apes actually beat the Hamburg Swashbucklers in the first round. Very big game for the Apeldoorn Apes. 2.5, 1.5. The Marseille Migrants thrashed Amsterdam. That's a bit of an upset there to win 4-0. That's a really big result for them. Reykjavik Puffins beat Abuja Rockstars. And the Desperadoes from Dublin have beaten the Cannes Blockbusters. That's a huge result as well for the Desperadoes. 2.5, 1.5. The London Towers beating the Lagos Leatherbacks 4-0. And all of the important games still going on in this remaining match. So, really interesting stuff.
People are very excited about the match of the Puffins. Obviously, again,
everybody loves the Puffins.
Everybody loves the Puffins.
Everybody loves the Puffins.
I like their symbol as well.
Yes.
It's simply amazing. And have you ever played the tournament in Reykjavik, Lawrence?
I've never played in Reykjavik, actually. I would love to go to Reykjavik, but I've never played there. So waiting for the day when I have time to go there.
You should go there. You should.
Yeah,
go
you've
there.
Been?
Yeah, I've been there. They're extremely friendly people, extremely nice people. Okay, so there is some action.
Yeah, we've had some mass exchanges. And if queen takes d4, queen takes f4 would be a huge mistake. So a beautiful and very important tactic. Bishop to h7, check, clearing the path for queen takes queen. So you cannot take that pawn on f4.
I have the feeling that Georg has just offered a draw, and this is why James is thinking. Otherwise, he would have taken on d4 at once. So
wow.
Play that. It's most likely not just playing that.
Wow,
he
okay.
He just considers this. I don't know if this is the case, but queen d4 is the obvious move, to which I suspect that
yes.
Black wants to play bishop c6. And this looks rather drawish to me now.
Yeah, this somehow should be a draw. The king can come up to protect the g-pawn and with the reduced material. Yeah, bishop e4, queen e4.
It's interesting. We don't have any results from this match at the moment. So
no, that's true.
It's extremely, extremely tight, I guess.
Yeah, very, very tight.
Very tight.
The other matches have started, by the way, so we will keep an eye on that. But we'll stay with this game before we go to the other games, because still have to finish this. Let's quickly check in with Yang Fang. Ooh, okay. Wow, what a position. Esterga has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pawns versus he's got 5 pawns for the piece. But Yang Fang is managing to weaken this diagonal. What an unclear position.
Still 5 pawns sound like a lot to me.
5 pawns are a lot, but you know there's always going to be tricks like rook f1 here. Queen can come to e7, come to f6. Checkmate is very easy. And even if you come here with your queen and take my pawn, a lot of the time I can just hide in the corner and there are no more checks. So like here, queen e7, that's the practical move, right?
Or queen e3 with the same idea, queen to e5 or queen d4, but you're not allowing them of d4 at the same time.
Hmm.
Probably from this perspective, it's easier to play with the white pieces because you're trying to deliver checkmate.
I mean, is it an idea just to go queen f6 anyway and just say, okay.
That's what he did. Yeah, he played your move.
Queen d7, actually.
Now queen f5, queen f4 is also a move. Queen
yeah.
f4, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
covering the square and threatening queen h6.
Okay, we've had an exchange of queens. And you feel, yeah, black will just rush his king out to d7 like this. Yeah.
If the queens are treated, I think that black should be winning this. He's no longer checkmated.
Yeah, the queens have been traded, and yeah, so feels like black should, but white has got a bit of a, some kind of a bind, and also this f-pawn is weak, so, you know, like rook c4, if I go rook f1, yeah, but this is not easy for Yang Fang.
It looks very temporary. Plus, look, he has only 12 seconds left on the clock, yes. So that's not survivable, practically, I believe.
Rook e4, rook f2.
Oh, by the way, in the meanwhile, James has been tricked by Georg Meyer, and Georg is winning the pawn ending at the moment. He's promoting to queen first, and yes, that's...
That's end of game.
That's the end of the game. Do you know the reason why Georg is playing the Rubinstein line of the French defense?
He's been playing it for years, quite simply. So, yes.
But not only that.
Oh, go on.
He likes to play end games, and he loves to play end games. And from this one, he can get easily into an end game.
Okay.
And he enjoys that greatly. So, yeah.
So what's the score with the London Lions and the Snowballs? It seems as though we have 1-0 for the Snowballs, and we'll get the rest of the results. Yes, I believe the other games are still being played. So this is a really brutal round for, let's go back to the Yang Fang game. And wow, this isn't easy to win with black either, you know? It's a really curious position because King d6, okay. He wants to go e5 and King e6. King c2. Come on, you've got to go e5. Let's go. Surely. Rook e4 first, King d3. You can also go maybe a3 and Rook a4. Yeah, that's what he wants to do. a3, Rook a4. King c2. Oof. Rook a4 now. a2, King b2, Rook a4, King a1. And e5. Something like this, but... still, this is like Bishop
people G4. Are helping us, and in the chat they're mentioning that there are two wins for the Stockholm Snowballs. So if this one is also a win, or even if it's a draw, it's good enough for them to win the match. I don't really think that he's going to let his opponent off the hook. Now e5 is moving, King e6, f5 is coming soon, so that's over, basically.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, so
I think he sacrificed the bishop. I guess this is play for stalemate now, but there is still pawn on c3, so
yeah, this is never gonna work. So it looks as though you can play rook takes pawn and King e5, and this is just a very easy ending to win.
Too many extra pawns, yes. The game of Ponomarev has just started, but the game of Bakro is actually already way ahead. Okay. So I suggest that we have a look at the game.
Let's do that.
Of Kintan against Baki, e3.
Yes.
Which was Sicilian defense, the Ruslan line with bishop b5, and Bakro answered g6.
Yeah, and we have a very interesting position. White is claiming that this pawn gives him a nice space advantage, blocking this bishop out, but I find it difficult to see how to develop the rest of my pieces with white. Maybe b3, bishop b2? And bring the rook to d1. That looks like a sensible plan.
Or maybe bishop e3 and directly rook d1.
Yeah, bishop e3 and rook d1 is also must be and very bishop, good.
And bishop c5, and bishop coming on c5, for example.
Right.
So that would be also an idea.
Quinton 94, for everybody who doesn't know, is Quinton du Carmen, rated 2468, a young and up and coming Dutch international master. And back e83, of course, is Etienne Bacquerot, who, a legend in the world of chess, one of the youngest grandmasters of all time, a prodigy, and still being around the 2700, 2710 rating for about, I would say, at least 10 years. Maybe more, maybe 15 years.
Who are you talking about? Excuse me, I was...
About Etienne. He's been a 2700 elite player for at least 10 years.
Oh, yeah. He's been around for a very long time.
Yeah.
In the meanwhile, while we are following this game, mm-hmm. just a reminder for all of the people here in the chat, guys, be more active. We're giving away 1 month free diamond membership. You're going to check the tools that we have here, the awesome tools on chess.com. So be active, ask questions and comment on what's going on. We will be very happy to answer your questions. So go ahead, don't be shy. Lawrence is not eating people here, you know. He will tell you a good story as well. Right, Lawrence?
I've got lots of good stories. I don't know if they are appropriate for this broadcast, but I'll do my best. But what we do have on the board here, Dejan, is a very, very interesting matchup. We've got Mertis Kazgalev from Kazakhstan. Right.
Yeah.
Mertis Kazgalev versus Ruslan Ponomariov. I believe Mertis, who is a grandmaster, of course, has been in France or was in France for many, many years. Is that right?
Yes, he lived and played for Cannes. He lived in Paris for a very long time. He speaks fluently French. Now he moved back to his to his country.
Okay.
As far as I know, if he didn't go back to France, but he has strong roots to France and the culture and the people. People still remember his amazing performances when he was playing those tournaments in Bastia.
Mm.
And the rapid tournaments in Corsica, he was one of the favorites there, and I think he won many times, including when I think he had also wins against no one else but Vishyanath himself. So he's an amazing blitz player, so watch out for his game.
Okay.
Lawrence.
Okay, I will do now. I'm hoping everybody can still see this. Can you see me, guys? It looks... Can you hear me, Dejan?
I can hear you perfectly fine, Lawrence, so I'm trying to...
So it says that the connection has been lost, but I'm still live and the broadcast is still live, so this is very strange. Let me see if I can go to another game here.
Maybe it was lost for a moment. I think it's working perfectly fine. Guys, can you hear us and can you see us at the moment?
I believe they can see us in chat. Let me just very quickly refresh this. Apologies, guys. I'm just going to do this real quick. Yeah, I'm being told I can be seen, so just bear with me for a second, guys, while I bring the games up. This is very strange because I'm live with you guys, and yet it's not letting me connect to chess.com, which is the first time this has happened. So, apologies about this, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, people can see us and can hear us. This is great. Unfortunately, I can no longer see the chat. Hopefully, it will come back in a moment. In the meanwhile, the beloved team of the Puffins, we didn't mention this one, but they won their previous match with 3-1 after the local hero known as Exhibit made a safe draw. And people are talking about this in the... in Twitter, and they're enjoying the next win of the team.
Okay. Um, I have no idea, ladies and gentlemen, why I'm not able to get back onto chess.com. In the meantime, let's have a quick look at exactly what the prize list is for the Pro Chess League. We can see there we have first place 20,000, second place 10,000, third and fourth place 3,000, so huge prizes. And what's really great about the Pro Chess League, Dejan, is how there are lots of other different prizes. There's a top female prize. There are rating prizes for under 2,600, 2,500, 2,400, and so on. There is even prizes for the best game, the best move, best blog, best video, and best performing social media. So really good stuff. And I believe last week, and rightly so, that Flavio Perez won the best game, defeating Maxim Vachier-Lagrave in a beautiful attack, and outrated by 500 points. He took home the $200, which was great for him. Now, the games are back.
Well done. Well done, Flavio Perez. And yeah, let's go for it.
Okay, so let's have a look at the games. And we are back with Murtas versus Ruslan Ponomariov. And what's going on here, Dejan? We have...
What is it that we have? Yeah.
We have a kind of Benoni defense with a knight on h5, made popular by none other than Robert James Fischer, Bobby Fischer, who very famously in his match against Boris Spassky played, was it game three, Dejan? I always get the game numbers mixed up. I think it was game two or game three.
Where... No, game two was never played. Game number one is the one with the sacrifice on h2.
Yes.
The blunder, and yes. Game two was never played. So that should be game number three.
Game three, where he played knight h5, and it was just an outrageous concept, allowing bishop takes h5 and pawn takes h5. It's not this exact position, guys, but what I'm trying to say is black wrecked his pawn structure on purpose in order to gain the two bishops initiative and be able to expand with f5. It was a brilliant idea that had not really been seen at the time. And I'm looking at this position and I'm thinking, well, there's something similar there, because in some lines, white is just taking this horse off on h5. Black has to be careful.
Yep, he definitely has to be careful. Both sides have to be careful, because you know that the Benoni is a very dangerous strategical opening for black.
Mm-hmm.
And if he is not careful enough, he can be easily smashed in the center. I have to say, in this position, if it was white move, he can drop the knight back, say on h2, go f4, g4, push, and you know, this avalanche is going all the way to the black king. He has to be careful himself, yeah.
Agreed, absolutely agreed. Okay, so...
Bishop e2. So yeah. This is what Ponomarev is thinking at the moment, how exactly to arrange his pieces against the plan that I have just mentioned. It's not that dangerous after knight h2 to allow bishop h5 even, but f4, g4 and e5, f5, g5, this is not nice.
This is a bit unpleasant for black, isn't it? I feel like this bishop on f6 is really misplaced, you know? It's not allowing black to play f5, the knight can't come back to f6, so... I feel like Murtas will be very happy somehow with this position.
It looks very easy to play also. Look how simple it is.
Right.
Well, black has to create something. He has to build a play somehow. Have you ever played the Benoni?
I've played the Benoni and I've got a terrible score with it. I remember Nana Dzagnidze from Georgia, still probably one of the best female players in the world. She was definitely top five. She absolutely crushed me at the Gibraltar tournament about 3 years ago. By the way, Gibraltar is happening right now, ladies and gentlemen, with the likes of Fabiana Caruana, Maxime Vachier-Lagrave, all playing. In any case, I played Nana, and she just destroyed me in a bishop f4 variation of the Benoni, and I had no chance. So my memories of the Benoni are... they're really not that good. So Yeah, haven't played it so much, I have to admit, since that time.
Kabubi is asking what's wrong with the move bishop g5. Do you mean bishop g5 in this position, Kabubi, or on which one? That would be a good question to answer. What's wrong with bishop g5? Why doesn't white like to trade the bishops in this situation? Normally he does, but he enjoys the bishop being on f6 at the moment, stopping black from playing f5 himself. That's why I believe white is going to postpone the trade of the bishop for better times, for more appropriate times. And he's going to make use of this bishop on f6.
Okay, knight takes f3, bishop takes f3 has been played. So now the question is, yeah, Ruslan has played knight g7, but I'm not really a fan. I mean, this knight hasn't got a bright future. So how to continue now with white? I mean, do you just slip this bishop back to e2 to play f4? It feels a bit slow.
Well, you can also put it on g4, which is interesting as well.
Yes.
But you have to be ready to sacrifice the pawn on e4 if you
right.
If you put the bishop back, bishop c3 and rook e4, people are sacrificing these pawns very often with pleasure. But the knight on g7 then will be a good defender.
I also am looking at plans like pawns b4 in the right moment for white, opening up the queen side. A move like rook b1 followed by b4 is not completely out the question, because the rook on b4 would attack b7 and it would protect b4. So some rook to b1 would be possibly interesting. Also, the move rook a3 comes to mind. To come to b3, attack b7, but also just, you know, protect c3. Tricky.
I think that ideally what he would like to do in this situation is something like king h2, g3, bishop g2, and f4. g3 and bishop g2, f4 directly would be best, but if g3, the pawn is hanging on h3. g4 is another idea, but on g4 there is a move like g5 that black very often uses in this Benoni type of structures.
Right.
And h6, maybe g5, bishop e5, some blockade on the dark squares. Do you like this idea, e5 followed by knight a4, knight b6, and knight c4?
I do, but the problem is I always worry that after a5, bishop d7, knight a4, bishop b5 comes. And this bishop hits this rook for a start. And also, it's a really annoying bishop to have there. And then if the rook moves, we can play, for example, queen e7, queen c7, and then bring the rook to d8 if it ever gets attacked. So, and I think it's like, draw?
You have a point.
They what do? Is this? What on right earth is this?
Your team strategy.
Kidding me? That should be illegal. How dare they make a draw in 16 moves in a 15-minute game? Well, I'm not happy about that. All right, let's go to another game.
Canton against Baki.
Yes.
Let's go to Bakro again.
Wow.
Both the players are very short on time, low on time. They have approximately 4 and 5 minutes each.
Mm-hmm. So what's going on here? Actually, Bakro is an exchange up. Let's make that clear for the moment. Of course. And knight c7, queen takes d6. No. And if pawn takes, rook is checkmate along the back. So this is losing for Quentin, who probably missed this.
And queen d6 is coming no matter where the knight goes.
Yeah, actually, he just resigned. So that's a good result for Etienne Bakro.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay, so we can go to another game. What takes your fancy, Dejan?
Let's go to another game. Which one would you like to cover? You want to go to Etzerga against Playdead?
Sure.
Some James Adair playing with the black pieces this time against Etzerga. Etzerga, I believe that should be Grandmaster. Actually, I'm not sure who of the two Grandmasters.
I think that's Yevgeny Agrest, is it not?
I'm not sure if this is Agrest or if it is the other Grandmaster Diamond playing.
I think it's Agrest because Esterga is an anagram of Agrest.
Okay, clever, very clever.
Yeah, that would be my guess. So I believe it's Yevgeny Agrest.
That's a brilliant guess. By the way, if you guys missed in the previous game, he sacrificed the knight on a3 as we predicted, and then rook c3. This is how he got so many pawns, 5 pawns versus the bishop of his opponent. And now he's trying to further on increase his success.
Indeed. And Yevgeny Agrest, ladies and gentlemen, many people won't have heard of Yevgeny Agrest. But Yevgeny Agrest has been in Sweden for many, many years, but is, as you can probably tell by the name, from the Soviet school of chess. I'm not sure exactly which city he comes from originally, but I think he emigrated to Sweden many years ago, but has got a Soviet upbringing when it comes to chess, a Soviet education in chess, which we all know is a very fortunate thing to have. So he's a very classical player in many ways. And he'll understand pawn structures and configurations, and he'll have a lot of chess culture, as my good friend Jan Gustafsson likes to say.
Yes.
So let's take a look at this position. I don't feel like James Adair should be in too much trouble here. This is a closed position, so there are no available pawn breaks.
A good question
in the center. Yes.
Just to interrupt you for a second, two questions actually. Yogul is asking if any world class players have played yet. Former world champion Ponomariov has just finished his game in a draw, and Etienne Bakro just won his game. So there are some other top players like Georg Meyer and some other grandmasters as well. And the other question, again, very, very serious question. How do you win Diamond membership, 1 month Diamond membership?
Yes.
Yes, the answer of Andre Maus is the right one. He guessed it right. He has to beat me in arm wrestling competition. But I guess, no, you have to beat Ruslan Ponomariov in arm wrestling competition. Seriously, if we have to be serious, guys, you have to participate here and to give your opinions and ask your questions, chess related, of course. Not anything else, please.
Yes. So be active in the chat and you'll have a chance at your Diamond membership for 1 month, which is a lot of benefits. So queen takes e7 played and knight f3. And the major sort of feature of this position is the minor piece interplay. How are these minor pieces playing against each other? Well, we can see this bishop on b7. It's not a particularly happy bishop. It's locked behind its own pawn. It really hasn't got a future, whereas this bishop on b1, even though at the moment the rooks aren't connected, its future is a lot brighter because this diagonal can be opened in a timely fashion with g4, or the bishop can come to d3.
I predict the move g5 at the moment for IM Laurence. I think he's going to grab some space there. Although, it also makes perfect sense to start rolling the pawns on the queen side with a6, b5, c4, b4, which is typically what he would like to do.
I like that idea. And I like this idea, g5. I think that's a very nice space-gaining move. Normally, we're told, Dejan, don't move the pawns in front of your king when you're castled. But this is a slightly different situation because the queen is very far away and it's not easy for white to get in behind this pawn advance. Also, the king can come to h8 and the rooks can come and protect. So this isn't G5 I like very much, actually.
And I think it also suits James's style. On the other hand, you mentioned something very interesting, Lawrence, about the future of these two bishops. And this is a concept which people were discussing for a very long time. And the Dutch players, they kind of disagree with this one, because what we have at the moment is a typical Dutch pawn structure, stone wall, except that the pawn from c6 is on c5. And I told you, James is my teammate. He should be listening to me, g5.
Good move.
Right. That bishop on b7 is not as innocuous as it looks like, because I have to say, this knight moves away from c6. It can go via c6 to e8 and h5, and it can join the attack on the king side, which is a very typical maneuver in this position. So I suspect that, yeah, here there'll be a6, b5, and to me it looks like it's much easier to play with black pieces.
Interesting.
Yes.
Yeah, I would agree with you, actually. Bishop e2, and now a6, almost certainly the move James will play to prepare b5, sometimes b4. And maybe this rook will swing round like this. G4 is coming. This is, yeah, a6 played. You know your teammate very well.
I know my teammate, yeah. Also, yeah, the rook from f7 to g7, the knight from d8 to f7, eventually to g5 after g4, it's, you know, it's quite, there are a lot of ideas in the position.
I agree. Yeah, not easy for white to find room for his pieces here. I mean, what kind of plans will white have?
That's a tough question.
Yeah, that is a difficult question.
Maybe b3 somehow, not now, because now b3, b5 is going to be embarrassing.
He played a3, but now I just like the move king h8 for black. I mean, come on, let's get the king on a better square, and we can prepare a rook to come over. Maybe we want to go g4, g3 with black, bring the queen over, just start bringing our pieces over to the king's side. Also, black has got this really interesting idea once the pieces have come over to do a kind of snaky maneuver with this bishop, either out here or out here. I like black's position. I think it's got a lot of potential.
I'm trying to follow the chat simultaneously while I'm talking to you, and there is a person who is complaining that he's asking good questions and we are not answering them. Please repeat the questions. We really have a hard time following everything.
Yeah, I'm following the Twitch chat. Shout out to everybody. Thank you very much. They're being very nice to us today, Dejan. They're enjoying the stream. That's what we're here for. To make this entertaining, fun, and instructive. So we're glad you're having fun. And remember, follow us on Twitter. You've got our Twitter handles there as well, because we are big Twitter users. We use it for the league and other things. Please follow us. That would be great. Okay, so James has started this maneuver. Bishop c8, bishop d7. And
he's going to h5, as we were talking about, and white is also preparing himself for this. There is a question by Strider23CPK, who says that he's a class A player, 1900 USCF rated, that wants to make it to 2200, and he's asking for advice how to get better. So if you can give him an advice, Lawrence, that would be great.
I think when you get to sort of 1900 and you want to make the next big step, really, for me, in my experience, the way I've helped people is you really do need a coach who's a lot stronger, I would say, in the international master region to have a look at your games. Because the fact that you've reached 1900 or 2000 level already means that you've got the basic concepts of your game in good shape. But what you need is to go that bit further. So you'll need to refine certain areas of your game. And, you know, Of course, to complement this, doing things like continuing with tactics, combinations, calculation exercises are always key. I'll tell you a story. I was at a tournament not so long ago where Veselin Topalov, former world champion, was playing, and countryman of Dejan.
Yeah.
And at lunch, before the game, I saw Veselin Topalov, who's rated 2800 or was then, reading a tactics book. So the reason I'm telling this story is that tactics and combinations and keeping the mind fresh are not just for improving players, they're for everybody. So keep your mind improving, you know, use strategic books as well. I would recommend Jeremy Silman's Reassess Your Chess. That's one of the big books that I used in my youth as I was improving. And get yourself somebody who can have a look at your games. And absolutely no question, you can make the next step. All right, so let's go back to this game. It looks as though Yevgeny has really made progress here, in my opinion.
Well, now White is back into business. He managed to push the pawn to e4. And yeah. I think James did not have to allow this, because now the knight is coming on f6 if he doesn't take it. Yeah. And now the white bishop is also in business, back in business.
Yeah, and the question is Agrest going to play rook takes f5? And boom, he does it immediately. Beautiful exchange sacrifice. Because now after knight f6 check, the king moves and queen takes f5. White, as a result of this exchange check, has got a monster knight on f6, plus these two passed pawns that can roll down the board, and this bishop, which can join the attack. This is a great exchange sacrifice, in my opinion, very natural.
And a very, very clear sign that the player who is playing with the white piece is a great blitz expert. Moves like that, which are taking away the chances of the opponent to get any counterplay, and which are putting him into on the defensive, a very, very typical. Also, knight e8 was a move here, winning the exchange back and winning the pawn ultimately. But I think he prepared already to take on f5. He didn't even consider knight e8
right.
for some reason.
Right. So knight e7 played, and now
26 most likely, and then d5 d6.
Yeah, this looks. Maybe after queen e6, he's slightly worried about a move like queen g6 with some counter chances. So maybe he'll play queen e4 just to control. Oh. Yeah, and he did that. So he played queen
well
e4.
Done. Yeah, well done, Laurence. Queen g6 probably still a move, but then queen e8 is an additional resource.
Now queen a8 is a resource, yeah. Exactly. So Yevgeny firmly in a driving seat, even if the queens were exchanged after queen g6. You know, white has got more than sufficient compensation. So I think Yevgeny is going to win this. Should we go to another game, perhaps?
Sure.
I can see that Grandmaster Tokras, a.k.a. Mathieu Cornet, is back in action, playing against IMSC, yes, from the Dublin Desperadoes. And, interesting position. Pawn has been launched up the h-file, and the king still on g8, so some ideas, but it looks as though black should be okay, in my opinion.
You like black here?
I don't like black. I think black should be okay. I definitely don't like black because I don't play the French or French kind of systems. And I always take the white side.
Yeah. Well, you need to have a certain stereotype of thinking to play the French. It's not for everybody, I think.
No, it's definitely not.
And it's not for everybody. You have to.
Yeah. Cd4, he's probably going to take on e5. But the great thing about the French defense is that if you don't lose, normally you've got great potential, very good, what I like to call elasticity in the position. Your pieces really can spring out very, very, very quickly.
Oh, I don't trust Black's position here, to put it mildly, to be honest with you. Maybe
right.
He should go f5 and try to block the king side.
What about fe?
He took on e5, but I think this is opening the white pieces only.
Hmm.
Ah, you want to take many times bishop
yes.
f6 and e5?
Yes.
But your rook will be hanging on e8.
Yeah,
it's not that easy.
I know. I wanted to sacrifice that guy, but it doesn't look like it works.
You're such an active player, Laurence.
I am. That is my style. I admit it. I'm guilty.
Yeah. That's why you don't play the French. If you'd like to play the French, you will play the main average, sacrifice two, three pawns, they go for the center. Looks like a lot of people are have joined the show today, and there are some technical issues, but I hope they'll be resolved very, very soon.
Yeah, we'll hopefully get results through for this round, because none have been recorded. They might all still be playing, of course. So maybe there have been no results. We're still only in the first half of the second round. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, there are four rounds today, every week. And there are 7 weeks, I believe, of games. And they are, of course, by division. And then there will be playoffs of those divisions and then the knockout phase. So that will get really exciting. And we should point out that even Magnus Carlsen, world champion, is registered to play in this league. So hopefully we'll see him make an appearance in one of these weeks.
Yeah, but definitely not today, because he is kind of busy at the moment in Vik.
He is.
Today he had a tough game against Hare Krishna, which he drew. And he's trying desperately to somehow chase Wesley So, but I think that he doesn't have a lot of chances doing this. Wesley is in a great form. What do you think about this?
Yeah, I was having a discussion with you, with Jan Gustafsson about this, Grandmaster Jan Gustafsson, and I said that I think Wesley has been the in-form player for the past 6 months in chess. His rating increases has been quite brilliant. And it looks as though Wesley So is big favourite to win the big Tata Steel Chess Tournament taking place in Vijf aan Zee now in Holland. And, you know, who knows? If he continues to play like this, Magnus has got another serious rival on his hands.
I think that Wesley is also part of the Chess Pro League, so we are about to see him here later as well, hopefully. In the meanwhile, what's happening with this game?
Well, it looks as though, I mean, I never quite know, because I'm just a bit worried about my king with white.
If you don't deliver a checkmate, you're not sure what's going on.
Yeah,
right?
I mean, that's normally the situation. But, you know, let's say white plays move like, I don't know, knight e3 here. If I take... knight e3, bishop takes e5, f takes e5, and play queen g5. The fact that I can't castle is very frustrating for me. So we see Tokras, aka Magic Cornet, play queen g4.
I think that Tokras was thinking about putting the bishop on d3 and then creating a battery on this diagonal. If he succeeds in doing so, it will become completely resignable for black. And but on bishop d3 there was knight d4, so most likely he was worried about this one. But to me, it seems that white is completely in control in this situation. And only that the pawn on e6 was hanging, but his kingside attack looks very serious to me. You're not convinced? Okay.
I want to be convinced, because I like playing white in these positions, but how do I checkmate? Okay, knight e3. And if I take on e5 now with the bishop? Are you playing d takes?
I'm most likely just with the other pawn, with the f pawn.
Okay. And then
queen f7, maybe you want to meet me, but I can play rook f1.
Yeah, I'm not going to go queen f... Well, I might go queen f7 to then play knight e7. Or I can play a move like knight b8, very deep move. So bishop e5, fe5, and knight b8, just to maybe exchange bishops like that. And the problem is that there's no... king h8 is also very reasonable. I don't know how to assess this position. I'm not convinced that white is doing amazingly here, actually. Unless bishop d3 is coming with serious consequences. That would be my only worry.
So, an interesting question from the audience again. Mm. Andrew Miles One is asking, will the age of top chess players continue to drop? Mm. Will we see 19, 20 years old in the world championship in 50 years? What is your answer to that one, Laurence?
Mm. Well, already, I mean, let's face it, we had the world championship match this year, Carlsen, Karjakin, both of whom are 25 years of age, and both of whom became grandmasters very, very young. And now we're seeing grandmasters become younger and younger and younger. We've even seen, for example, in the Viking Zay tournament, Tata Steel Chess, Wei Yi, the wunderkid from China, who is only 17 and already rated 27-20. So it wouldn't surprise me to start seeing really, really, really young players compete for the world title. And I think the reason for that is because, quite simply, it's a lot easier to get access to information and learn chess more quickly nowadays than it used to be. When Dejan, and even when I was growing up, there was no, there was certainly limited amount of chess programs on the computer. So books were our source of learning and knowledge.
Yeah.
But of course, now this has been replaced by the computer, which is also much stronger. So the actual level universally has improved. And with computers, you're also able to be a lot more concrete in your approach. So lines, openings, and variations that were once considered to be unplayable just because they looked bad, now actually you can't say it looks bad. You have to analyze it out because the computer might just say it's fine. So the whole dynamic of learning chess and chess assistance has changed over the years. And yeah, so to answer the question, I do think we will see some very, very young players play.
And it should be noted that the age at which the players are trying to play is also decreasing. Now we have world championships under 8. People are talking about world championships under 6 even. Once it was considered even medically bad for the people to start playing tournaments until certain age. But Vinik, for example, started playing chess, learned how to play chess at the age of 13 or 14. I think 14. Nowadays, we already have grandmasters at this age.
Right.
So most likely, the age of the players for the world championships might be even lower than 19, 20 in 50 years, maybe 18. There might be players playing for the world championship and even 17.
Very, very possible. Okay, back to the game. And we can see here that, as I mentioned, it's not that easy for white to launch such a huge attack. Knight a5 by black, opening the c-file, maybe threatening to even come to c4 with the knight. And then if the diagonal were open, suddenly this bishop would come into play. So mm-hmm. I think this is a very, very unclear position, with the king still in the center.
Knight a5 and knight c4 is the thing to do. Even if he sacrifices a pawn, this bishop should be brought into life. But positionally, white is standing so nicely.
Mm.
I mean, okay, a6, bishop d3, this is just pushing the bishop to a better position, but then...
He wants to go b5 and knight c4, that's what he wants to do.
And he will,
yes.
Seemingly.
So he will land on c4, but the question is, you always have to be worrying about a bishop takes h7, king takes h7, queen g6 and h6 kind of idea. But it seems as though rook takes f1. Probably now you go king takes... No, knight takes, actually. Not convinced white has anything here, actually.
Yeah, too many pieces have been traded. He is not going to checkmate your opponent, for sure.
That's for sure. Okay, are there any other games? Let's see that we've got very interesting games going on, of course. This is round two of this week's Pro Chess League, the Central Division.
Let's have a look at the game between Tvaburov against Robik Kivlishvili.
Okay.
This is Tvaburov playing with the white piece, another teammate of mine from my Belgium team. He's playing his countryman, Robik Kivlishvili, who is a very talented junior player of Netherlands. I think he's about 16 years old, maybe. Pretty young. Not sure exactly how old he is, but he's pretty young. They have just started the game.
I'm also seeing, just out the corner of my eye here, Murtas is playing against Ruslan Ponomariov again.
Again? Oh, this is what happened. They have restarted the game, most likely, because of the issues that we had.
Is it also that there might be a 30 move rule? Draw? We're going to get confirmation from our chat about that. Perhaps one of the admins can tell us, is there actually a 30 move minimum before you can offer a draw? If so, that maybe they were asked to repeat the game.
I have read the regulations, but I don't remember this, to be honest with you. So we will be waiting for the people in the chat to answer. But definitely, I think they have restarted the game. Because here in the chat, there was a Grandmaster Nuki, who is one of the players of the Marseille Chess Grandmaster. I forgot his name, just disappeared for a moment from Yanni Guzzoli. He was asking a question, what happens with the game, and I think they restarted his game as well, and most likely this game has been restarted as well too.
Okay.
The technical issues that appeared for, I guess, the reason was that too many people have loaded and were following the games, and this caused some problems here.
So a lot of the games have been restarted?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's good for us. That means we have more chess. And so we can see a very quick look at the standings just to update you on the games. The Stockholm Snowballs are crushing the London Lions 6.5-half. The Lions in desperate need of a comeback in the second half of the match. The Towers beating the Lagos Leatherbacks 4-0. And we still have all of the other matches in play in round two.
There'll be a new video coming very soon from the Puffins, I guess, because IM Exhibit he just posted a very short video on the Twitter, just 8 seconds, and he's showing behind his back, look who is watching my games. I cannot hear what exactly he's saying, but right behind his back there are Robert James Fischer and and Boris Spassky playing their historical match. You know that this match was played in Reykjavik, and he says, this guy's probably, this is what I believe he's saying, this guy's watching me, that's why I need to play tough.
Okay, well, let's have a look at this game. So we're in move 18, and Ruslan Ponomariov played the Benko gambit, a very interesting gambit. On move 3, we can see b5, sacrificing a pawn, and a6, named after Paul Benko, who the Hungarian grandmaster who emigrated to the United States. And this gambit is all about gaining play across the A and B files to compensate for the pawn that you lose, and having this marvelous g7 bishop. It was one of my favorite openings as a junior, and it served me very well. It served me very, very well. But as I became stronger, I noticed that white replies were becoming more difficult, and I decided that losing a pawn was not the way to go. So
Lawrence,
yes.
I am Thomas Rendell just mentioned in the chat that London Towers just waiting for round two to start. Obviously, there are still some issues with the transmission, but I think it will be getting better and better. Okay, so we have queen b7 attacking the pawn on b2. I know that in these end games, because I'm also getting those from the King's Indian defense, and people don't really like to allow the bishop to go to c3. The black player doesn't want to allow this, and right now it seems like white did everything properly, and he stabilized the situation, so Ponomarov is going to suffer badly in this game.
Yeah, it's as a general rule, if you play the Benko Gambit, one thing I learned as a very early on was that don't allow white to get the b3 a4 construction, because suddenly it's just a full pawn, and you have to play moves like queen b4, yes, and try and stop these pawns, but actually this is very difficult. So a move like rook fb1 would be very normal here. Even rook fc1 makes a lot of sense, perhaps with queen b2 check, rook c4 can come, knight c4. There are a lot of ideas, and even playing on the king side here with white. You play rook fc1, which I think is the best move, to even go f4 sometimes, but you don't always want to move that f-pawn and weaken your king. Knight e5, and now the question is, will he go f4 with the idea that knight d7, knight c4, or is f4 going to run into queen d4 check? Let's put that on the board. f4, queen d4 check, king moves, and then a nasty knight g4, and the knight is landing. Nasty. Yeah.
Very nasty, yeah. That's why queen c3, very good safe move. Very safe move.
Good move. Rook takes c3. Yeah, and now Ruslan is simply trying to make a draw. He's not hoping of anything else.
Most definitely, yes. So he's looking for a good moment to play c4 and to try somehow to take one of the pawns, the B or the A pawn. But it's not that easy. White has very stable construction. Now, the other thing that black is looking for is the move f5. F5 followed by whenever this pawn disappears, rook d4, the pawn on d5 might be in danger. So I guess it's not that horrible as I thought at the beginning.
Yeah, what black has managed to blockade this side. But maybe after f5, white wants to take, and then play knight c4. And black does create more weaknesses along the e-file. So I don't think Ruslan's going to play f5 too quickly.
I'm trying to follow the chat because I'm still waiting for your creative ideas, your creative comments, and I'm still looking for somebody to award him with a 1 month diamond membership. If you guys want it, come get it. Ask your questions, show interest of what's happening here, support your team, and be active above all. We're here to answer your questions.
And g5 by Ponomariov, so a completely different plan, but one that makes perfect sense. Ruslan wants to secure this knight on e5 by stopping white playing pawn to f4. But my feeling is that you can't do that forever, especially if white just plays g3 here. So, you know, white is definitely in the driving seat. Also, king f1 just coming, bringing the king. King f1, king g6, king e2 almost certainly now will be the move, improving the king.
The question is, where is the king going after that? Is it going to stay to e3 or is it going to go further to c2? That's an interesting question, but okay, Ponomarov is trying the play that we were talking about, somehow trying to reach the pawn on d5. You know that Ponomarov was famous for his defensive skills all the time? And it was the defense that gave him the win in this match against Ivanchuk.
This is absolutely true. And he was only 18 years old when he beat Ivanchuk. So
probably this also answers the question of the person here in the chat who was asking if we're to be expecting matches like that. We already had one.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Question for you,
Yes, Lawrence. Please. Tell me.
Yes. Who have been your biggest foes?
Who have been my biggest foes?
Yes.
My biggest enemies. Good question. I mean, when I was growing up, of course, people in my age group, I used to play a lot. I would say David Howe. I played a lot in my youth. I've got a terrible score against David. I've also got a terrible score against Gawain Jones. I've got some good scores versus other grandmasters. But, you know, because I never truly played professionally in a lot of games, I don't have so many foes, so to speak. So, hope that answers your question.
I don't really have foes. I mean, people who have defeated me are not really unpleasant to me. That's one of my problems in most of the cases. I'm generally friendly with people, chess players. I'm not Korchnoi, for example, or Butvinnik. You know, Butvinnik, right. Before a match, he would put a picture on the wall of his future opponent, and he is going to curse him and to tell him bad words, and he is going to get into shape like that. I could have never done this before.
Yeah, that's a bit old school, right? I don't see Magnus Carlsen doing that either. So times have changed.
Hopefully they have changed. Another question for us, actually for me, if there is a general endgame rule for pieces left on the board before pushing pawns, he likes that viewer of ours, he would like to know when to go for pawn promotion. Well, basically you push the pawn only if you're sure that you're going to promote it into a pawn. So you need to have all the support, and after you get all the support, you push it. If you push it prematurely, there is a very good chance that people take it. And that's why whenever I'm teaching my students, I always tell them to first improve their pieces, their kings, and only after that to look for the pawns. But of course, if you have calculated a good line in which you're pushing, and you're turning it into a pawn, into a queen, that's fine. You can go for it. Did you play short? That's a question for you, Lawrence.
Actually, I have played Nigel, and I can happily say that I've got a 50% record against Nigel in classical chess, which is good for me. I played him at the Gibraltar Masters a few years ago, and I was actually much better at some point, and played slightly inaccurately in the ending. I was never winning, but I had a very pleasant position. So I played Nigel. I've got 0 out of 1 against Mickey Adams. So not the worst records that some people have. And it looks as though here we're in for a bit of a repetition. If Rook B4 followed by Knight C2, we do have a repetition. And despite having the extra pawn, Murtas is really struggling to see how to make progress. And I like what Ruslan did with his configuration here. So Knight C2 is already a draw by repetition.
So at the time, that's going to be a proper draw if they do it.
Yeah.
He's thinking if he should be playing more. Rook D1 is a move. Of course, he can go further. He can try to push a bit. Rook D1 followed by Knight B5. No, Knight C2.
Well, Rook B6 is... this is definitely 3 times.
Yeah, that's a draw.
Okay. So, a good result for Ruslan, I think, given the opening.
Let's have a look at the game of Bakro playing with the black pieces against Quentin. Quentin.
Quentin.
Quentin.
Yeah, Quentin Dumarco.
Didn't they play already?
They did, all of the games have been restarted, I believe, because.
But he won that game, didn't he? Or did...
Yeah, it's because of technical issues. I believe they had to restart the entire game. So, so we've got this game again. But still, Baki is doing absolutely great here with black. These knights are a bit misplaced for the moment. Although white isn't in huge danger. I still think rook fd8, bishop a6 sometimes. I don't know. Feels like black should be in control. Rook fd8 played.
More questions, fellows? More questions? We're here for you. And for those players who are battling at the moment.
Yes. So, yeah, Quinton with a very underwhelming position as white. What I also don't like is this bishop on a2 is kind of staring at a brick wall here. Yeah, so knight e3, but now, let's see, what would I play here with black? Knight a5 is definitely one of the moves, because now can't defend this pawn on e4 very easily, if at all. You might, and if you go bishop b1, that's disgusting, because now knight b3 and you'd have to go rook a2. This is bad for white. This is just bad.
Yeah, definitely. This is bad. Black has the only open file, so that's definitely priority here.
I think maybe you have to go b4. No, I think you had to go b4 there with white. Yeah, because now knight b3, rook a2, this is disgusting. And maybe you can even go a5 with black. The idea of a4. You've got ideas of f5 as well, g5. Knight d2 is a move. Lots of moves.
Why didn't he go b4? Why did he allow this knight to jump on
b4? Yeah, you have to go b4 there. I mean, for me, that's just insane to allow knight b3.
Right.
And it takes three moves just to get the rook back.
Well, true, if he goes bishop c2 and takes it, he's going to free the rook. The main problem is that this rook on e2 is arrested by a knight now. It's practically has the same strength as the knight. He excluded his rook.
Yeah, and this is a nice move. Knight c6, threatening if bishop c2, he wants to bring the other knight to a5. That's a really cute maneuver, keeping this rook out of play. No, this is beautiful technique by Baki. h4 is not going to worry him at all. Just knight a5.
Baki just, I wonder what happened with his son if he won the second game too. That would be interesting to know. We are still waiting for some of the results though. Appledorn, Apes, Hamburgs, Bucklers, Swashbucklers.
Yes.
2.5 to 1.5. That's the one from before.
We will get an update of all the results as soon as we can once this round is over. But this is just very unpleasant for white, and it's kind of like he doesn't have any really good moves. He has moves, but not really good ones. F6 is a really nice move. Also, perhaps planning e5, f5, but stopping knight e5.
And even g5 is a pawn.
And even g5 is...
any of the pawns.
Really nice move. Bishop c2, I wonder if he'll go g5. Maybe he'll just go rook d7 and say, okay, I'll double on the d-line on the only open file.
This might be interesting for all of yours to learn. Whenever we have an isolated pawn on a2, like here, strategically there are two plans to play with the black pieces. For Bakro, he's trying to treat all the remaining pieces. That's the first one. Or B, he's trying to play on the other side of the board, on the king side, where he's practically up on exchange. But look how tricky white is. He played the move knight c4. He's playing himself. That was cute.
That's a very nice shot, actually, that I think Etienne missed.
That's brilliant, yeah.
Because if knight takes c4, bishop takes b3, suddenly I've got to worry about this pawn. So I wonder if Etienne will just go bishop a6 here. And if knight takes, knight takes. I still prefer black because this rook is so badly placed. But it relieves some pressure, at least, this move.
Look at this question, Lawrence.
Yes.
What is the best opinion and best team, in your opinion, in the league? And who is on it? That's a very good question.
Very, very difficult question. Well, I would say that, you know, the likes of Cannes And the French teams especially are very, very strong. Both teams have got a number of grandmasters, and I think they are going to be really fighting for the top spot. Of course, the team with Maxime Vachier-Lagrave, Maxime, one of the world's best players. So they are ones to watch. But also, you know, even teams like the Hamburg Swashbucklers, full of a bunch of young, very strong GMs and IMs. The Stockholm Snowballs also have shown this week that a bit of experience can be very useful. But I would say one of the French teams is probably going to be looking to win this league.
Yes, well, there is a strong American team with Hikaru Nakamura in it. I think the Miami team has him, and it's an extremely strong team. I think they are the rating favorites. But there is the Chess Brass, an extremely interesting team as well. We have Fabiano, your very close friend, Laurence.
Yes.
Why don't you tell us about Fabiano? How is he doing?
Well, he's actually in Gibraltar at the moment, so I'm not sure if he's going to be playing tonight. Obviously, he's played a full game of chess today. He's got a big game tomorrow. So I would be surprised if he played tonight. I was working with Fabiano for about 2 years until very recently. I was his manager. We had a very nice couple of years together. And I wish him all the best in the future. And we're still on extremely good terms, but we had to part ways, as happens with many sports and managers. And I know Fabiano very well, and he will very much enjoy playing this league when he has a moment to do so.
Okay, back to the game then. What about this position now? White managed to save his rook, but is he really okay here?
No, you have to feel like back row is still doing great, but maybe Quentin wants to go a5 here? Yes, he does.
He did.
Point is that knight takes a5, bishop takes e6 is obviously a good trade for white. Also, the pieces are kind of tangled up here. So knight a5, bishop e6.
But then rook d1.
Rook d1, okay, I can take this guy. Rook d1, king h2. And definitely white has... White has benefited from all of this. Now b4 is a really... Even b4 immediately has to be analysed. So I'm not convinced that Etienne has played this correctly. Yeah, he took first. Okay, takes, takes. King h2 will be played.
Bishop d3 perhaps. I have the feeling though that black is still better, to be honest with you, because he has the queenside majority. If he manages to start pushing the pawns there, he will have an extra, he will have an outside pass pawn.
Yeah, but the problem I have is that after bishop d3, what happens after b4? Precisely, this is why Etienne played this move.
So you
have to stop this b4 idea. But now you've given a beautiful square to this knight. I think I would play knight d4 very quickly here. He played bishop d5. Okay, maybe...
So playing bishop b7.
Also a very good move, actually. Now, I'm starting to... Well, I don't prefer white just yet, because my rook is still completely out of play. But my position, I feel a lot happier about here. Knight's coming to d4. Not easy to make progress here.
I think he needs to bring his bishop into the game. Maybe bishop c8 now and bishop g4 being one of the ideas. And then also the king can follow. King f8, d7, d6, eventually c5. But he played f5, which is another reasonable move, trying to undermine the bishop on d5.
Now I think white will go knight d4, or is he going to play some cute move like h5 also? Possible.
h5 is not a threat. He can just go g5 here. Your bishop is hanging.
Sorry?
If you go h5 here, not threatening to take on f5, I mean black can play g5. Because
yes, and then I wanted to go knight d4. And secure some squares for my knight in the future.
I get it.
was an interesting idea too, but yeah, Quinton definitely improving his situation, in my opinion.
Yes.
Any other big games going on? This is quite a big game for this round, actually. So hopefully we'll get an update as well on the scores very soon. Ah, so takes and bishop b5. So now knight d4, bishop d7 will be played, I believe. No other move makes sense. And then, you know, even here, I'm wondering, does white play, does he play like king f3 to come to e2? I'm just not sure. Very tricky position, huh?
Yeah, extremely, yes. The knight on a5 is standing there to arrest the rook, but the knight itself is not in the game, and I don't see how can black play this for a win at the moment, but he will definitely try somehow.
Maybe pawn to f4 here, gaining some space. Bishop d5, I'm not sure I like that.
There are some tricks with bishop c4 and rook a7.
Ah, he wants to play bishop c4 and rook a7. That's beautiful. That's really nice. Baki has to be careful. Okay, so he avoids that.
King f4, obvious move. Then g5 is also obvious. Is he going to play, though? I don't know. Maybe rook e1 first, and then g5 is a move that he can always play.
Mm-hmm.
Is b4 still a threat? I don't know when exactly did people ask this question, maybe some time ago. B4 right now most likely is no longer a threat, as black and trade a lot of stuff there, and he will get the outside pass pawn. A pawn is going to be extremely a strong passer, and any endgame like pawn ending is going to be lost for white. Most likely bishop ending too, and even the rook ending will be very tough for him. So white would try not to do this unless he's forced.
Okay, g4. The point is now, if the bishop moves, white would love to throw in g5 check. So I wonder if we're going to see g5 check first by Baki 83, not allowing white to get in. I think this is a favorable check for white to fix the pawn on g6. Indeed, Baki does play that.
Also, there are some tricks now. If king f3, there is bishop b1, and on rook e1, there'll be bishop b4 check. So beautiful. He might...
Yeah, king g3, well played. Okay.
But isn't rook g1 now winning a pawn? Am I missing something?
Bishop g2.
Bishop takes g4. Isn't king, he just grabbing a pawn?
No, yes, no, yes, yes, he is.
Oh, well, definitely maybe.
Definitely maybe, that's yep. True. But what would be going on there? So takes king f3.
Oh, knight f3, there is knight f3.
But then bishop takes f3.
Yeah, so he's winning a pawn.
Yeah, he's winning a pawn. Rook g1 check does win a pawn.
Or maybe he's trying to trap his rook after that somehow. Is he capable of trapping his rook? King h2, rook g4, something there.
Yeah, there's nothing there. Knight f5, king f5 is nothing. Tricky. Rook g1, what to do?
No, I don't see anything else but king h2, honestly. Bishop, rook takes g4, and then maybe knight f3, trying to lock the rook for a while, at least. Still thinking, Bakro. And he's getting low on time. He's getting below 4 minutes.
Yeah.
Which is
wow, he didn't play it, so he was not happy about something there, which is, I have to say, very surprising. Very, very surprising that he didn't play this move. Okay, so
people are asking if we point out the openings that have been played in some of these games. Yes, you have a point, fellows. Yes, this one, this opening here, we're trying usually to always say the openings. This one was again, this was Sicilian defense, but quite a real line by white with bishop c4. I don't even know if this has a name. Most likely doesn't. And some close type of position got here at the opening.
Right. Okay, so bishop f3 on the board. And okay, so yeah, white has done well to kind of not be losing immediately, but still after the problem is black would love to go rook d2, but then I think white would sacrifice the b pawn. Rook a1, rook takes b2, and rook e1. Now I like rook a1. Let's get the rook in.
Lawrence, you're going for checkmate in the endgame too. You're an amazing attacker. It should be very difficult for people to play you.
I am very difficult. The problem is when they stop the attack, that's when it's a problem. Go rook a1 here. Knight b5. Wants
to grab a pawn.
A6 and knight c7. So simple, huh? Mm-hmm. Win a pawn. Also very reasonable.
So Bakro will have to finally bring this knight into the action. Knight b3 maybe immediately, maybe...
But knight b3 immediately looks really dangerous, no? I mean, apart from knight takes a7, I have to consider rook takes a7. Mm. And yeah, my king is a bit kind of open on f6.
But this pawn is doomed anyway.
Yeah, this pawn is doomed. That is a fair point.
He's taking pawn b to first. Of course, yeah.
Of course, he's playing this. This is also why rook a1 was interesting.
Your move. Well, rook a1, he can still play here.
Yeah, the difference being, of course, that in the other line, the rook was coming to e1 with real venom. So... What is he thinking about? I mean, rook a1 looks like an only move to me. Rook takes b2, knight takes a7. And rook b3. Okay. Yeah, this looks like... but this is not a threat. Ah, it is a threat. Is it a threat? No. Actually, I wanted to go bishop b1, then I realized rook takes c3 is check. So knight c8, so this isn't a threat just yet. And also, white is now threatening knight takes b6. Very cute idea with rook takes a5.
Very few pawns are left on the board, so this one is heading towards a draw, I think. Although, how do you really stop them with knight b6? Maybe just bishop d3, knight b6, rook b6, rook a5, rook b3, and you take on c3. And this is how it's, everything will be annihilated and how the game will end ultimately in a draw. What do you think, Lawrence?
Very possibly. Yeah, bishop d3 has been played. Yeah, I mean, you really, you could think about rook c1, but I think it's very optimistic. I think you just do this takes, rook b3, and then some check. And if the king goes back, maybe come back. Yeah, win this guy, and should be a draw.
Lawrence, I think this is a question for you.
Yes.
What do you do if your wife says you like chess more than me?
That might have happened. I'm joking. What do you do if I tell my wife or partner that I like chess more than her? That's not a good, in my experience, it's not a good thing to say. Although my partner, she knows that I play a lot of chess online, so I like a lot of bullet chess and that kind of thing, but she still gets preference, you know, she's a good girl, so I will.
Look at that, Lauren. Sorry to interrupt you.
Yes.
King g2, such a sneaky move. Now, if rook c3, there'll be knight takes b6. Give me the knight on a5, give me a fork on d5. White is playing for a
Beautiful.
win. He is tricky.
Yeah, he's being very tricky and a very good move. King G2, I like it very much because it's also out the way of this rook x-ray on the third. And this knight has got no squares, actually. So King G6.
Already giving up the pawn. Knight b6 is taking it.
So knight B6, rook
Bak
B6,
Bakrov
rook
long time,
A5.
just 1 minute on his clock.
Yeah.
That's not too much. True, he gets 2 seconds per move, but you never know.
Absolutely. Is White seriously considering just rook c1 here to keep the pieces on the board and claim that this knight cannot move? No, he went for knight b6. Okay. Rook b6, rook a5, rook back to b3 will be played.
And then
And a
check, check,
check.
check,
And
check back to
maybe.
a5, I think. Rook a5.
Yeah. This feels like it's heading towards a draw, doesn't it?
Yeah, we mentioned this line already. Oh, you want to give a check on a7, which is going to be the same.
And the Stockholm Snowballs have actually won their match already. And that's incredible. They've got to 8.5 versus London Lions are getting drilled today. The Stockholm Snowballs have won with what, how many ever games it is to go? More about half the games to go. So great result for them.
I'm actually very impressed by the result of Apeldoorn Apes against Hamburg Swashbucklers. Hamburg, they have two grandmasters in their squad, Twan
Yes.
Burg and Rasmus Swain, and they're being heavily beaten at the moment by the
Yes.
young Dutch players. 5.5 to 2.5, that's impressive. Two more rounds to go, and they're on the ropes. Very difficult match for them.
I agree. Very, very difficult. This is just going to end in a draw. Quentin's going to realize that he's got nothing better than this. But is back row thinking about taking on c3 here and gambling, or is it too much?
Well, in the worst possible case, White is going to sacrifice the bishop for the pawn, so I don't really think that he needs that as well. And the team situation, I think Marseille, how are they doing? They're doing perfectly fine. They don't have to risk. He will take the draw.
Oh! He's found a route. He's found a route.
Oh yeah. All
He's not just
right.
playing for a draw, it seems. He's not just playing for a draw, it seems.
Oh yeah.
Interesting. Now Quentin only has a minute left.
Yeah, but rook a5, king f4, rook d5, and again the checks are starting. I mean, you cannot really escape from that.
That's true.
But he's giving it a try.
That is true. Rook d5, excellent move. Well done, Dejan, for spotting that. But rook c3, I check here, check, I come back. Just check again, huh?
Check again, yeah, until I take
Maybe
on
king.
g5.
Yeah.
But maybe your idea will happen with the sacrifice of the pawn.
Yes, that's possible. Yes, maybe he's going to sack it, you know? He's going to go not all in, perhaps, but yeah, king f6 on the board. Check.
Yeah, check. There'll be a check on d4 coming. In the meanwhile, let's finish this one, and then I'm going to ask some more questions from our viewers.
Yes,
Rook
please.
d5, rook d4. This is let's finish that one. Just a couple of moments, I
Okay.
guess. there a very long time.
No, he does decide to do it. He wants to win here. He's giving up this guy because it's difficult to actually stop this pawn when it...
But it says that he lost on time, or maybe there is another connectivity issue. Hopefully not.
Now I like the move bishop e4. Because if takes, I go rook e5 check, I win this pawn, and I come behind. Ah, he played it like this. I'm not sure. Bishop e4, c2. Ah, but that's a draw. Okay.
My board is not moving for some
reason. Oh, okay. Maybe you need to refresh it.
Yeah, I'm on move number 54. Okay, I'm going to refresh it. Because you said that the Bakro lost on time already. Okay, move number 61. So your idea has been played, actually. He sacrificed the pawn on g5, but in a much better version. And now... Now bishop e4 would be answered by the very sneaky bishop g2 move, which is most likely not winning after king takes g2.
also rook f5 check is more than enough more there. Than
yeah, okay.
Okay, rook d2, bishop d3.
Whoops.
But no, but you can take on d3. Well, no, rook g1 check. Sorry, the rook is... We win the rook in... now it's just losing, probably.
Now it's just losing.
Yeah, rook d3, c1 equals queen. No, this is just...
That's where the check, yeah.
But there's just no time. King f3, maybe?
But he's getting 2 seconds per move. That should be enough for him to win. That's
queen f4 check is just winning immediately. Oh, shame for Quinton. You know, a shame, but...
But... He was so close, but credit to Bakrok, who kept on playing in a seemingly dead draw position in the position in which most of the people would just repeat the moves. He kept on doing it, and he proved once again why he's such a great player.
Fantastic player. Okay, so great win for him there, an important win.
The question, this is a very interesting question.
Yes.
Let me find it. I think I lost it for a moment because there were a lot of questions. Do you think the vast access to chess could dilute the game? Kind of like how video making resources have gotten easier and easier.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So the big question is, like, have computers diluted the game or have they enriched the game? There are some players at top level who still believe that computers are bringing new ideas to the game and computers are aiding us in as much as ideas that were previously seen as defunct or unplayable are nowadays playable and vice versa. So the computer does add certain something, but in terms of creativity, which is what I think the question is talking about, it's much more difficult nowadays to get an original position, especially out of the opening. And as a result, a lot of players are complaining that, you know, with so much computer analysis, there is a certain sensation that chess is losing its uniqueness. But we can see in top tournaments, there's still extremely hard-fought games and new ideas that are coming. So I don't think we're at the stage where we need to panic just yet. But certainly to reach the very top nowadays, you have to put in so much work just to stay in the game.
Yeah, very well said, Laurence. That was really very nice. Let's not take a break. Let's keep on looking at the games.
Yeah.
Which game are we on for?
We're on Ruslan Ponomariov playing Deluti. Deimante.
Deimante.
Yeah, and weird position at the opening where we had what's called the Piek defense and the Lion's Jaw variation, F3. Leading to some crazy complications like this. And Ruslan in a very belligerent mood, looking to punish Deimante. And I have to say, I prefer white's position very much here. Black is yet to get castled. Although, you know, after a move like bishop d3, if he ever gives a check, maybe the king will just come on d7 and it's quite safe there. So let's say bishop d3, knight c6, check, and then just king d7. Maybe black's got enough play. Also, knight c4 check is coming. We have to be very careful about that.
So people, again, keep on asking questions. We're trying to answer every single of those except for watching the wolf movies. I'm not going to answer this one. If you want to answer it, it's up to you.
I don't know what we'll skip the wolf movies for the moment.
And there is a viewer who is constantly asking, what is your opinion on the bird's opening? And he's a bird's player. I will answer this one. If you like it, just play it. It's so simple. You don't have to have, you don't need to have anyone assuring you it's a great opening or not. Bishop b5 check. Ooh. Why is he doing this?
I think he wants to do that because he doesn't like knight c6, actually. Now he is going to come back to d3 or maybe to e2 even. And he's saying, actually, your knight wanted to go to c6, not your pawn. So it was a provocative check.
Quite a nice idea, yes. Well, from that side too, queen g6.
Aha, now if queen f7, maybe bishop d3. Possibly. Difficult to say.
I thought that he would like to use the b5 square for the bishop, but no, he used it for another piece. On queen b7, if you go on queen f7, if you go bishop d3, there'll be knight c4 and pleasant in between check. So maybe on queen f7 you have to check it. Because queen f7, bishop d3, knight c4 check, now only move seems to be king e2, and then knight e3. Black should be fine, I think.
Yeah, I think black's okay here. I have a feeling black is fine. Deimantis is a fighter as well. Really fights very hard in every game. What are the scores at the moment? Should we check those out? We can see that the Snowball's crushing the Lions 9.5 turn off. They've already won their game.
Yeah, and that's kind of surprising to me. I thought that the Lions have a very good squad.
Yeah, very, very surprising. And the Towers beating the Lagos Leatherbacks 8-0. Well, that match is more or less over. They only need half a point, the Towers.
I saw on Twitter that they won one of the games by default.
Right.
Forfeit, yes. Round two game started. We win one by forfeit, so now 5-0.
Shout out to my boy Truth Cracker in the chat. Thanks for the thumbs up. I appreciate it. I try and do my best here, guys, with the commentary. Hope you're having fun. Let's return to this position. So Ruslan has won a pawn.
She didn't play queen f7.
Very strange that she didn't play queen f7. She's played king d8, but I don't like this maneuver. She wants to put the king on c7. But it just feels a bit slow.
Yeah. The king side is suffering.
Yeah, rook's coming to g1. Also, like king c7, rook c1 here. I already have to worry about knight b5 check and knight d6.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but above all, the main problem I think is rook a to g1, for example. And even if you have king c7, if you go king g8, rook a to g8, there'll be h6 and the flank falls apart. Basically.
Yeah, h6 might be very strong. It takes even h6 now, takes queen takes rook, rook takes, and then rook takes. and then you double on the G line and penetrate on the seventh.
Yeah.
Yeah, Ruslan played king c2 first, which is a prophylactic move against any checks. But if king b8, h6 might be very strong, because now we take the rook with check. Yeah, h6 is just winning, actually, I think. Just too many pieces.
Too many pins after that with the rooks coming on the 7th and the 8th rank.
Yes.
He's not in a hurry, yeah.
Yeah, actually, maybe he doesn't even need to do this. Maybe he's just saying, okay, I'm going to do it and then do this. There's nothing you can do to stop it. Mm. Also, he might do this and then retreat the queen back to d3 and then play h6. Yeah, this position's a disaster for Dame Mantis. She needs to do something quickly. She needs to play some move, c5 or something, because she's just way too passive.
Yeah, she needs to open the game there to get some chances.
Maybe a6, c5. Just don't worry about this pawn on g7. Yeah, she played c5. She realized she absolutely must open the position.
Very interesting question about the women. Why are they? Why do the teams have women in their team? Maybe it's a good moment, Laurence, to mention again the prizes that we have.
Yeah,
the biggest prize fund ever on an internet tournament, team tournament.
Yeah, absolutely. We have the screen there, ladies and gentlemen, of all the prizes, and there is a top female prize of $1,000 for the league, which is a nice bit of cash for playing some chess at home. And of course, this league is all about encouraging female players to play. Many are playing every week. And some of the strongest female players in the world are playing as well. I mean, just look at Diamante, rated 24-21. Definitely, I would say, a top 30 or 40 player in the world in women's chess. So it's very important to encourage as many strong and improving females who are playing to participate. Very important indeed. So I like that very much.
Daimantek has been the leader of the Lithuanian team for many years, clearly the top player of this country, besides Chmielytė. But Chmielytė is no longer playing actively, and now Diamante is the leader of the team. I'm not sure what will happen now that she got married to Mathieu. Is she going to switch to France? We're about to see. But in any case, she's a very strong player, even if she doesn't do so well against Ruslan, but not yet is over. Don't worry, there is still play. Even if she loses, I think it's not such a dramatic thing.
No.
Anyone can lose to Pono, right?
No, of course Ponomariov is outrating Diamante hugely, and yeah, on paper is a much better player, of course, but anything can happen. It's blitz, and we saw what happened with MVL. At least Diamante has done something. I immediately like this, what she's done, you know? Now the question is how to actually make any use of it. That's the problem. The problem with her position is it's so bad that... Do you just go queen b4 and hope? Queen b4, knight a4, knight c4, queen b4, rook c8. Whatever. Just go queen b4. Just go queen b4. That's what I would do here. Desperation. But even queen b4, you know, rook g4 is really unpleasant.
And d6 will be hanging after that, yeah, rook g4 and d6.
Yeah, that's really unpleasant. This is just unpleasant.
Let me get a pen because I want to write the names of the people who are participating in the chat.
Please
and
do,
asking
yeah.
questions, yes, because we have a free Diamond membership for 1 month to give away today. And I need to know some names. I need to see you guys taking part of this event as much as you can.
Okay, rook c8. So something, you know, trying to get some play generated down the c4. Pono is the kind of guy that will just go king b1 as well. You know, queen g7, queen b4, there's some kind of complications there, so. Okay. Queen b4, let's go. Okay. A sniff. There is a sniff. But again, rook g4 is just very unpleasant, is it? Is it? It is. Maybe now knight. Ah, the problem is knight a4 runs into bishop takes a7 check. Yeah, this is really bad. This is really bad.
Yeah, well, what we were thinking about actually did happen. The king side disappeared. Now the only thing Diamante can be hoping for is some queenside attack, some knight jumping on a4 and queen b2 ideas on knight c4 and queen b2 ideas.
Yeah, but bishop takes a7 is such a big threat. I don't even see. Maybe she has to go knight c4 here. But even this after takes. So knight c4 takes. You can't even go rook takes because this is hanging. This is hanging. It's just all hanging. It's all hanging, you know. It's just bad news. Probably she has to go bishop e7 here.
Knight a4 also doesn't work because of bishop a7.
Precisely, yeah.
Yeah, so. But if you start moving backwards two pieces, bishop e7, this is... Then the e3, where is your queen going? That's horrible.
Yeah. Oh, rook takes h5. Okay.
Bishop f2 seems like it's winning material.
Yeah, this is a winner for sure. Yeah, and Diamante only with 2.5 minutes, more or less, so this is very difficult for her, in my opinion.
Queen g6 is also a move. That's an important win, actually, for the Dublin. For the Dublin Desperados, because with this win, they are leveling the score, at least for the time being.
That's true. And
then it should be up to the other French players to keep the balance positive for their team.
So Pono taking some time here just to try and calculate the most efficient way. But if he's a bit imprecise here, you know, Black is in time to consolidate a bit, right? So, you know, there's all kinds of hidden threats here. So you've got to be careful. As I said, Diamante, very resourceful player, very, very good player.
When very tactical, yeah.
Yeah. And, so he just took on b6, queen takes b6. What's this? Winning a piece like this, but hold on. Doesn't it feel like Black may have something here?
With which piece?
Rook takes e5? Or is it just not enough?
You don't have pieces. You can get checkmated first. Queen c8. No, queen c8 is not working because of bishop d8. There'll be a way to stop this. But bishop d3 simply.
Rook e5, bishop d3. But then hold on. Queen f2. Queen f2 is check.
Okay, king b1 checks.
Rook e1 check.
Ah, now they're getting too many. Okay, now I get it.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying it's enough, but I'm saying there's play here. There's play. Yeah.
There is something there, okay?
Yeah.
Laurence, your eyes are getting filled with meat at the moment you see an active move. How about if rook g1 to g2? Maybe this is going
to... Yeah, you can do... Which one? The rook... Yeah, rook g1? Maybe there are player move like bishop f2.
Bishop f2. Then my idea with queen c8, king c8, rook g8 check, rook
king
g7 7, check.
And then king d6 at the end?
No. Knight b5?
No, your king c5? Is it mate? No.
Rook c8, king b4, a3. Maybe I will mate you there. I will mate you.
You will?
I think so.
I don't think you will. King a5?
B4?
King a4?
Knight c3.
King takes a3.
For one move. There should be something there.
It feels like it's nearly mate, right?
Yeah. But okay, let's make it more prosaic.
But also rook g2, like, we have to worry about these moves as well, d4, right? I mean...
No, but d4, queen d4, rook d4. No, but on bishop f2, I would take it prosaically, queen f2, queen d6, check, and I take on e5. No need to go for
that's checks. Very, very strong. Okay, rook g2, how about this? Bishop e1.
That's more unpleasant.
Bishop e1. Let's, you know.
I confess, yeah.
Deimati, she only needs, like, a couple of moves here. It's not over.
Yeah, and we can see that Ponomarev is thinking heavily, so yeah. He's suffering here.
Yeah, this is kind of unpleasant.
A question here for me while we are waiting for his move. When playing a game, you know you can't win. Is it best to play it through to be able to learn more from it? If it is on the internet, for sure. If it is a game like it is here, team game, I would suggest that you don't do these experiments. Depends on the situation, but I think you can definitely learn if you try.
Yeah. So how about bishop e1 here? It's slow, I know, but you know.
Rook 1 to g2 was played, so...
Bishop f6, maybe. I don't know. I mean, I'd love to just go a6 and just give some room for my king, but I feel like it's too slow, probably.
No, but on bishop e1, the simplest is rook g8, killing this most important attacker, and that would be it, I think.
Nearly. Rook takes e2, check.
Rook takes e2.
Rook takes g8.
Rook takes e1.
And then rook g2, check.
Rook e2, just in time.
And is it just... Yeah, she played bishop e1. Okay. rook e2, yeah, there it looked like you're just in time.
Yeah, because if you go away too far away with your queen, I can checkmate you on d8.
Right, precisely.
I think rook g8 will be played here.
Yeah, rook g8 is a very, very important move. Yeah, I think rook g8 is actually the end, unfortunately for Deimante. It's been a great game, though. Really interesting game.
But I have the feeling that Ponomarev is calculating the line that they told you with queen c8.
Yeah,
he's trying to find the checkmate there.
that wouldn't surprise me. No, he just played rook g8. He's been
cold-blooded, maybe?
Cold-blooded, yeah. Very practical, rook g8. She played rook e2, so we're going to get this. Rook g8, rook e1. Rook g2 check, probably rook e2, but maybe she's going to go d4 or something. But yeah, I mean, rook takes e6. Yeah, it's just not enough for Deimante. Yeah, cool piece. Quick look at the scores of this round, and we can see the swashbucklers still struggling, 6-3 down at the halfway stage, more or less. Marseille Migraines crushing the Amsterdam Mosquitoes, 7.5, 1.5. Abuja Rockstars getting crushed by the Puffins. And the absolute closest match is actually the Cannes Blockbusters versus Dublin Desperadoes. So this is a very relevant match. Check. Yeah, she's going to try for a bit here, but yeah, I mean, even knight c3 here. King d1, no checks. Pick up the e6 pawn. 15 seconds, no chance.
Yeah, rook g2 move has been played.
Yeah.
But, okay.
Not enough. Queen takes e6 is just simple.
Knight is tremendously good defender. There are no checks now. It's defending the king to the left, to the right, to the center as well.
Queen c4. So she's trying something, but just
queen e5 check.
Yeah, queen e5 or you know,
trading the queens, queen d4, queen h8, queen d4.
Queen h8, queen d4, yeah, that's good enough, yeah. Diamante will resign after queen d4. And great game by Ruslan Ponomariov. Okay, so let's go to, we mentioned the Dublin versus Cannes matchup.
Yes, very close match. Nuki.
Yeah, Nuki.
Versus Svesimus.
Svesimus, but is Nuki playing for the Cannes Blockbusters or the Marseille Migraines?
Oh, no, sorry. He's playing for the Marseille.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Yeah, he's playing for the Marseille.
So we really want to see, because the Marseille Migraines have basically crushed the Mosquitoes. So
yeah,
we'll try and get another game with the Blockbusters. Should have some games here. In chat, let me know if there's one particular game. Because I cannot... Ah, Baki.
Did you find him, Baki?
Baki is playing, but again, I think that is the...
The old game?
The other French match, yes. So... Where are my Cannes versus Dublin matches? Shout out to me in the chat, because I'm struggling to see them.
There is Tokras against Astonish, so this is a game.
Yeah, this is a big game. Where is that? Because I couldn't
see it. It's under the...
Gibraltar games.
The Gibraltar games, yes.
Okay, let's bring that one up. And... Still, it's, I don't know how far under it is, but I'm struggling to find... Ah, here we go. Tokras versus Astana. So, wow, what a position. This is really a very important game, but it looks completely winning for white, right? It
looks like checkmate to me, huh?
Yeah, I mean it... But that said, there is a cheeky little 9f3 here, so white has to give checks here.
Rook b7 being the most obvious.
Yeah, and then king c6.
And rook c7, and that's
king
it.
D5.
A king d5 only moves.
No checkmate just yet.
Oh, yeah.
And 16 seconds for Astana.
Rook c5 and queen f8 for starters, and after that.
That's very strong, yes, and that will be played surely. Yeah, that's very strong. And queen f8 with check, and the king can't escape, and it's mate. King d5, knight b6. Is checkmate.
That's a beautiful checkmate.
Yeah, knight c7, knight b6, whichever. Ah, no, it's not mate yet. Sorry, knight c7, king c6.
But still, it's going to be checkmate after that with so many pieces around.
Just knight b6 is the best move. King c6 or queen d8. There's just mate in various ways here.
Yeah. Yeah, now, right. it was mate, king c5, queen b6, followed by knight c7, checkmate. That was
very, very nice. Very, so that means that with that win, are they all 5-5? Is that possible that it's 5-5?
It is quite possible, yes, because Ponomariov leveled.
Wow.
Leveled the score.
Wow. That's brutal. Oh no, Cannes have just taken an advantage, 6-5. With this win, they've just taken the advantage. So they've taken the lead, 11 games. Of course, there are 16 games per session, so 5 points still up for grabs. And London Towers beating the Leatherbacks 10-0. Just brutal whitewashing. Okay, where to go? So, number of games have started in the next round. The London games have started, for example.
I'm looking for the most interesting game at the moment to choose for you. How about we look at Georg Meyer's game again? It's below...
Yes, why not? Always fun to look at Georg Meyer.
Ooh, another end game. This time he's on the receiving end, though.
And he's playing...
He's playing Mesut
GM.
GM.
Mesut GM, but this is bad for Georg, right? I mean, he's struggling here. But it looks like he is going to win this pawn after knight e1.
The one on d3, right?
Yeah.
That's the key one.
Check. King d7.
Where is the knight going after that?
Maybe he wants to go king d7, king f5, knight e1, and then knight g6.
Knight on h4 is king, unfortunately.
Oh, so it is. Even that's a draw, but I think just maybe.
Not so sure.
Not sure either. But knight g7, much better move. Knight e1, knight g6, is this the idea?
Yep.
Ah, so takes first, clever.
No more this idea, okay.
Yeah, and now knight e1.
Knight Bjork is good.
Georg is strong. Georg is strong.
His opponent is on 36 seconds only. Wow.
Very difficult to play. King g4. Maybe king f5, but knight f2 then. Oof. Very difficult to play. King f3. Okay, bring the king back. I don't feel like it's enough. It's not easy, though.
We have an update in the chat from Hamachur, who says that Murtus against Buletvinnik in Dublin match is drawn.
Okay.
So, but people still cannot find a game of Sam Collins, whose nickname is IMSC. I am Sam Collins.
I am Sam Collins, yeah.
Didn't he become GM already?
He never became a GM. Sam was very close. I think he's got all the norms.
I think two norms the last time I saw him.
Oh, maybe two norms. Yeah. This feels winning.
Yeah, Henry Fool says that the mosquitoes failed to infect Marcel with deadly bloodborne pathogen. So we have to agree with him, I think.
Yes.
Looking at the score.
Indeed.
Puffin's winning by even more.
Yeah, the Puffins are cruising. The Towers are completely cruising. They've all won their matches. The Migraines have won their match. So really, the only matches that are still up for grabs are the Desperadoes versus the Blockbusters and the Appledorn Apes against the Hamburg Swashbucklers. The Appledorn Apes only need a point and a half. Actually, sorry, point. Just one more game to win. And, King D1? And King D4, very strong. Georg Meyer. Knight C5. End of game.
Crashes Georg Meyer.
Beautiful.
Incredible in the endings. Here another question for us. Is it difficult to recognize openings based on middle and end games, or does it come naturally once you get experience?
Good question.
Yeah. You go ahead, Laurence.
You can, Dejan and I would absolutely be able to recognize a certain opening just by looking at a position in a certain middle game. Not always 100%. Some openings can have similar structures, like, if there's an isolated queen's pawn position, that can come about from a Karakhan, a Scandinavian, even a Nimzo Indian. So there are
many
certain
openings, yeah.
Yeah, many things. So there are certain openings where we couldn't guess the exact opening, but from a Sicilian position or French's, these are normally very easy. So yeah, the more games you play and the more games you analyze, definitely you can start to notice which openings this all came from. All right, where to go? So we've got, do you know what's a really interesting game? The game...
Bucky?
The game Chess Flav versus Ruslan Ponomariov. And I say this because last week, Chess Flav was the hero beating Maxim Vachier-Legrave. This is Flavio Perez, my boy.
Exactly.
Who
a hero.
He was a hero because he actually won the match as well, which is, it was just the most heroic game.
Yes, I read about this. And you guys, you can also read about it on the chess.com column, news column. Don't miss it. If you have missed the shows, don't miss the news, at least.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, do you think that he's going to repeat this amazing victory that he had against Maxim Vachier-Legrave by beating the former world champion Ruslan Ponomarev?
What a that would be amazing 2 weeks. I would say, well, who knows? Now he's got the confidence. Actually, I believe he was on 7 out of 8 going into the third week, performing at like 2,700. Yes. So, like, definitely on for one of the rating prizes. And I'm going to bring that up again. For all of you who didn't know, there are a number of rating prizes. So he would be qualifying for the under 2,300 prize, $200 in the bank. If he manages to do that, and he must be in first position with 7 out of 8. So Chess Flav. And Ponomariov, we've got an Italian game where Ponomariov has gone knight g8. This is an old favorite of mine. You move the king to h8, knight to h8. Looks strange, but you want to prepare a very quick f5. And hopefully pin. So f5 will be played by Ponomariov here. And it's kind of double-edged, but very well-known idea.
Yep. I agree with you.
Okay, f5, e5. Bishop f5, knight e3, a very typical way of combating this.
This was the favorite way of playing of one of the Bulgarian grandmasters who passed away. He liked to attack this way with mm-hmm. f5, and he had a lot of wins and a lot of analysis. His name is Julian Radusky.
I remember Julian. Yeah, he died very young, didn't he?
Yeah, a great fighter himself.
Yeah,
great fighter.
That was a few years ago already, no?
3 years, I think, already. Yeah,
very
great gentleman. Mm. Great gentleman, by the way. One of the stand-up guys of the Bulgarian chess.
Mm. What a sad story, yeah.
Mm. Okay, so...
Okay, so a5, very typical device by white. Gaining space and also potentially threatening a6 himself. I was always a fan of going either rook b8 or a6 against this. The idea of rook b8 is that if you go a6, you can then reply with b5 in one go. And also your rook isn't on this awkward diagonal. But a6 also has a lot of merit. So I think Pono will probably play one of those moves. Unless he... Yeah.
a6.
Yeah, he's going for a6, which is very normal. And now with white, you have to look at moves like d4 and assess what happens after e4, knight d2.
Right. Also, bishop d5 is an idea, but you have to watch out for knight f6.
Right, exactly. So I think if I were white here... Yeah, the problem with d4 is e4, knight d2, knight f6 is a bit unpleasant. Queen b3. Now... The question is, are you threatening that? Ponomariov thought he was.
Well, probably he just defended without even thinking.
Yeah.
Basic instinct, you know, they attack me, I defend.
Now the question is how to proceed with white here. Not easy. Not easy.
Queen b3 has the advantage that it has removed the queen from the possible pin after bishop h5.
That is true.
Knight d5 is an idea now, maybe.
Yeah, knight d5, and if knight f6, are we just taking that knight?
Maybe just take the bishop, even though it seems a bad piece. It's a bishop. Then knight g5 could be an idea, or bishop g5.
Yeah, I like knight d5. I think that should be played.
Well, I think he's afraid at the moment of the rook f3 sacrifice.
That's I know he's looking at that. Yeah, very typical exchange sacrifice, destroying the white king side. But...
Probably it's not that dangerous. Huh?
Possibly not, yeah. Very difficult position, isn't it, to play this? And 10 minutes 50. He's going to invest here. He played h3. Wow, okay.
The leatherbacks got their first win on board On the board, 11-1 is the final. It is in the final round is remaining. So yes, that's great news for the Leatherbacks.
They got a win.
Way to go. In the meanwhile, the Snowballs already won the match against Lion Chess because of the 4-0 win in the last round.
Okay, knight f6, Pono deciding not to give the exchange. Now maybe knight d5, but it feels, well, bishop e6 maybe. So prepare knight g4, knight d5, something like this. Also, bishop e6 might introduce sometimes the rook can have some influence along the fourth.
No, I think he definitely needed to play the move knight to g5. Now, when the knight came back on f6, black's play is very easy. Knight h5, knight f4. e4 sometimes also threat. d5 if you move away the queen.
Yeah, it's either knight d5 or bishop e6. Ah, knight g5. Also, okay, of course, makes a lot of sense. Should have really pointed out that move.
But d5 now? Isn't it working?
D5, knight d5, knight d6.
It's not working, most likely then.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Changing my mind then.
Yeah, this is. And Flavio really rises to the occasion. He really rises to the occasion, so.
Such a dangerous player that Flavio is.
He's very dangerous, yeah. Absolutely. Queen d7.
What else can he do? Now he can repeat the moves if he likes. Bishop e6, bishop c4. Although bishop e6, black is not forced to repeat, he can go queen e8.
Yeah, that's true.
But knowing Ponomarev, I will say he will repeat once to make his opponent believe that he is playing for a draw, and then he will go queen e8. He's tricky.
Yeah, he could do that, definitely.
But he knows that he needs to play for winning this game. His teammates are hoping that he's going to win, and their match is very, very close. He's in a desperado situation for points.
Indeed.
Who's Chess Fluff again?
Chess Fluff is Flavio Perez.
The guys, aren't you reading the news? We already told you to read the news. This is the man with almost perfect score, 7 out of 8, who spoiled the almost perfect score of MVL Maxim Bashielograf in the last match, in the second match, and the person who gave the win for his team.
Absolutely.
And don't forget to ask more questions, chess related. Did they stop playing? Asking the people.
Bishop f7. All right. This is
another checkmate. Hey.
Yeah, he's hoping for, well, bishop takes f7, knight takes f7, king g8. Knight h6, king h8, and then the beautiful queen g8 check, but unfortunately knight takes g8
doesn't work.
But actually, just on positional grounds, this is a very, very good move. White wants to exchange light squared bishops and keep his control over e6, so I actually like this move very much from a strategic point of view.
And from pure tactical point of view, if they check twice and play d5, aren't they trapping a queen with rook f8 after that? Oh, you have knight f5 just in time. No, knight f5, I'll take it.
You can take it. Yeah.
So how are you going to save yourself?
I'm not sure we can, actually.
It's a mouse trap.
Yeah, it's kind of backfired, isn't it? So basically.
Oh, knight g4. Knight g4.
Okay, rook f8?
A knight f6.
Uh-huh, and.
And the queen escapes via h5.
Wow. By the skin of your teeth.
Yeah.
Wow. Shout out to my boy N4 in the Twitch chat. Thanks very much, Enfo. I appreciate the comments. Knight h5. Okay.
Who pays for the prizes? This one, I'm not sure.
I believe this is all raised from chess.com, thanks to the very generous management at chess.com. So,
chess question for you.
Yes.
And for me, where did you earn your highest norms? Meaning, how many grandmaster norms do you have?
I have two. Two grandmaster norms. So I won a tournament in Italy, open tournament, and I made another norm in a closed grandmaster tournament here in Hamburg, actually. So still on my list of things to do, complete my title, but played a few tournaments, didn't go well. I need to actually do some real work before I manage to do this. So yeah, what about you, Dejan?
You know, it's kind of difficult when you have to do coaching, training,
yeah,
and live shows, and to get concentrated on the pure specifics of playing chess. I was lucky to do the norms before that. The last norm that I did was at the European team, the European Individual Championship. Mm. Excuse me. The second one was in a tournament, the team chess tournament in France. And what was the first one? I forgot my first norm, even though it was the most important one ever. Time flies. First norm, I had one norm in the giant Istanbul Open, which they finally said it doesn't count for some reason. And I don't remember where was the other one. Sorry about that.
Okay.
I am Trent. You get your GM. Look at GM Grand at 49. People are cheering up for you.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, Julio Grand has actually been a grandmaster for like 30 years. So, you know, he's been a GM since forever. So it's difficult, but it's still possible. So I'm thinking about maybe playing a few tournaments in the near future. We'll see. But yeah, you never know. And let's go back to the game, because we haven't looked at this for a while. So Ponomariov has doubled his rooks on the f-file, but that is well covered on f2. And
but probably he wants to chase away the bishop from g5, go g5 himself, and jump knight f4 in the future.
Very possibly.
Although right now it seems like both sides are kind of having a grip on the other, on the opponent's position, and it's difficult for both of them to make progress. Right. Look at this knight on d5 hitting c7, not giving a chance to the rook to go away from f7.
Right.
Sometimes white is threatening to jump with this knight indeed and to attack the queen. So Ponomariov has to watch out.
Not easy for Ponomariov here. Not easy at all. And if g5 now, well, firstly we can just take it probably. Mm-hmm. But also there's ideas of queen g4. I think white would like to exchange the queens, if he could, in this position, to release some of the tension around d5.
And then he can try to start pushing the pawns on the queen side, like
precisely.
B4, C4, and B5.
Precisely,
yes.
Yeah.
So the C6 move can backfire at the end. Somewhere in the distant future. Inspired by Bobby the Puffin's get first ever Pro Chess League win. Breaking news, Puffins win their first match.
Wow, great news for the Puffins. That's important. They were big favorites against the Abuja Rockstars. So big win for them. Currently 13-2 up. only need one more point really to finish that.
Seriously, I cannot remember my first GM. Norm, people are laughing at me that they cannot. I was so happy when I did it back then that I immediately forgot about it.
Ponomariov in the tank here. Over a minute spent on this move. And, you know. Okay, knight f6. Okay, so we have I think we have to take it.
Knight f4 is so similar, but there is queen f5.
Ooh, knight f4 is tricky, isn't it?
It's kind of tricky.
It's really nice, dude. Well spotted. Knight f4, the idea is queen takes queen, knight takes g6, intermediate check. And if king h7, knight takes rook, another intermediate check before recapturing here. So knight f4, and if
this is
queen
possible,
f5,
actually.
g4?
G4, yeah.
Ah, he didn't do it. Knight f4 was really interesting.
From the other side, knight b4.
Even this is not totally ridiculous. Because now if queen takes c4, d takes c4, I want to take. And if knight e7, maybe then move like c5 is possible. Flavio playing really, really well.
Maybe d5 is a move now to stop all these things.
D5 right now?
Yeah.
D5, queen h4 check. King g8, bishop c5 possibly. White's pieces are a bit strangely placed, right? Now maybe bishop c5 feels like the move, possibly.
Another interesting question for us. How has your chess routine evolved as you grew in experience? Does it begin to get more refined towards your playing style?
I never really had a routine. I wish I studied. The truth is that I never really studied the game properly. So, which is good news because it means maybe in the future, I'll have chances of improving, but different people have got different ways of studying.
Right.
So.
Okay. So back to the game. Don't forget about the game. It seems like Ponomariov is getting the initiative on the in the center with the c4 move. Mm-hmm. Asking white a tough question. Would you like to close your own bishop with a move d4, or would you like to take on e4 when my knight jumps on e4 and it's getting a very good piece? Chesflav chose the third option, rook d1. Neither does know that he's defending the pawn.
Very decent. Very decent idea.
I don't quite see how is Ponomariov going to win this, but he will try, definitely he will try. Rook e8. So both are waiting for the moment when these two pawns are going to get traded and preparing for this. Now give me that pawn.
Yeah, this isn't easy, is it, for Pono? And, you know,
No.
I don't think white should be worse here.
Yeah, most definitely, yes. In case of king h7, he can just take on e4, and there is no knight e4 because the pawn on on d5 is hanging. And if there is no such move, knight h7 looks like the logical choice, yes.
Okay, queen g4. Is a repetition best? No, Pono's not going for the repetition.
He needs to win. His team needs this win.
His team definitely. Let's have a look. What is the current score in the team?
Not good for.
Yeah.
For them. Oh, Budger won the second game. That was the leather backs. They won one. A Butcher won the second game against Reykjavik Puffins.
And the Apeldoorn Apes have beaten Hamburg Swashbucklers. So big result for the Apes today. And a lot of these games are coming to a close, I believe. Just looking at things now, 11-5 in Stockholm versus London. So there's only two games left. There are just a few games remaining of this week. We'll stick with this one because this is such an important game.
The closest one. This is the closest match for sure. Would you prefer to study out of books or online? Which do you think increases how much you learn?
Well, I mean, there's so much information online, so many good websites, chess.com amongst others. So learning chess online is definitely a way forward, but books are really nice also. There are some real beautiful, well-made books, which are, which are just as good and contain many gems. So I would definitely research the books because I think they are still a great source. Many collectors out there. So yeah, books are good. You know, even recent series like Garry Kasparov's My Great Predecessors. What a fantastic series that is, full of brilliant analysis and games. So lots of good books out there. Okay, Queen D6. Now, is the idea is he wants to go Rook F4, followed by Bishop D4? Is that at all possible? Yeah.
This is the idea, but Black is threatening C5 and D4 and back rank checkmate, so most likely he will go B4 first? No.
Maybe played C5. Maybe after C5 he goes B4.
Oh, yeah. But then D4.
And then BC?
I take on B4.
On what?
On B4, I'll take on. Oh, no, you take BC, excuse me, my bad.
Yeah, I mean, I can take back. I mean, I have all the dark squares covered, you know? And yeah. Chessflave offered a draw. What a draw offer. That's very interesting. He knows he's better. He knows he's better. And he also knows that a draw will win it for the Cannes Blockbuster. So he can't say C5 played. So now I expect B4. This feels like the right move. Go B4. Don't think about it.
Think after, yeah.
Go think B4, after. Think after. CB4, you can go Rook B4, you can go CB4. He's done it. Excellent. Well played.
Wow.
Yeah, and
Flavio is such a beast.
He's a beast. Yeah, somebody can update me on his current score, but it wouldn't surprise me if he's like gained another load of points.
He was 7 out of 8 before this match. I don't know what happened after this match. 2800 plus, I think, or 2700 plus. I don't exactly remember. It was huge rating performance. Yeah. And it wasn't only the win against Maxim Vashiela-Graf. He was just playing very stable chess, obviously. Yeah, sorry.
Just very admiring Chesslav. And now he's more or less equal on time. So D4, Pono has to mix it up. But what's the idea? Bc5, does he want to go D3? Cd6 and E2 like a boss? Wow. That would be sick. That would be sick. That might work. That might work. Wow. So D3, Cd6, E2. Queen d5 check. Queen d5 check. Or does he want to go?
King f8. Rook e6. Rook e6, d7.
Yeah, queen d5 check. And also I've got queen takes b7 check. So hold on, king f8. Let's just check. This is just one check, right? So like d7 here. Queen check, king h2. Rook d8. It's not enough, yeah? Wow.
Rook h4 is coming.
No, rook h4, knight takes d5.
Oh, queen is hanging. Sorry.
Queen is hanging, yeah. So d7, he's given the check. King comes to h2. Rook comes to d8. I think that's the only move. And now,
Ponomariov, you see how nicely he's calculating.
Yeah, he's extremely strong. And now it looks like you have to go into hustling mode, take some pawns, because you've got some double pawns. But this is a struggle. Queen takes b7, rook takes d7, queen takes a6.
No, rook d7.
What is that? No,
that's
a whole queen. No.
Wow.
All right. So Ruslan Ponomariov, former world champion, wins. But the Blockbusters have won anyway. So the match is over. And in the big match of the round, the Cannes Blockbusters have beaten the Dublin Desperadoes despite recruiting former world champion Ruslan Ponomariov.
And that's we have some news from the chat that Sam has drawn with Diamante, so Cannes have won this match anyway.
Yes, Cannes have won the match, precisely. So I believe there are only a few games left in this round, this week of chess. We'll go to some... So let's go and see Thomas Rendel. Let's see how he's doing, playing CM Stuffings 101. Well, this isn't so interesting. Thomas with some control, but it feels like Black should be... Oh, Black's a pawn up. Black should be doing very well here, actually. So Thomas doing well there. We've also got the game Stop Trying Hard against Quinton. And
are these the only remaining games?
These are the only remaining games, I believe.
Astanis Murtas 73 is the last game.
Oh, and Astanis Murtas. Let's go there. These are two very exciting players. Okay. So Astana is an exchange up and a pass, baby. A5, let's go. A5, king d7, a6, king takes c6, a7, queens. You got to go with the baby. Why not go with the baby? Oh, okay, this is also strong. Take on f7. This is completely winning for... You got to go. A5, go! Go!
I can feel that Lawrence is getting overexcited, and very soon we are going to offer the 1 month membership to one of our viewers. So guys, be active. Last chance. Help the pawn get promoted. The baby. Is it baby?
Yeah, it's a baby, but now maybe rook b2.
Big baby.
If rook takes b2, c takes b2, a7, I make a queen, king g2, and then I've got a very important check on e4, which looks winning.
Yep.
So now maybe you have to go rook b7 with white. Ah, rook b2 first. Yeah.
But why can't he go on rook b2? Ah, he cannot go rook e1 because he gives a check and he stabs the pawn. Wow.
Oh, he played. Ah, he's just going rook b7 here.
The simplest.
That is rather simple. And actually, the king rushes in now.
And the f pawn is also there, so that's a little bit too much.
Yeah, this is way too much, actually. There's nothing to be done here.
But this win is coming too late, as they have lost the match anyway.
Yeah.
But now it's going to be 7.5 to 8.5. That's the closest match of the evening.
Yes. Absolutely. Certainly is.
Who is your favorite YouTube chess video maker? What a question.
Danny Wrench. Who else, man? Danny Wrench, chess.com. He's a boss playing his bullet madness. I love that. Watch some of that stuff. That stuff is really, really good stuff.
You enjoy watching bullet, don't you?
I do. I do enjoy watching bullet. I do. So, yeah, Astana has won. So, that means that Stop Trying Hard against Quinton. And this... Actually, I'm not sure this is such an easy draw. With these weak pawns and the king cut, like, even the queen ending here, but that said, you know, king b6 is a fine move. And, you know, only black can win this position. and not fun at all. The king rushing in to attack these weak pawns. And if you don't exchange queens, your king is just so exposed. So I expect a win here for Quinton, actually, without too much difficulty.
Yeah, if the king was closer, that would be another story, but not like that.
So king f1. Just take it. And go king c5. King
c5. Stop trying hard.
King c5.
Or king a5.
Or king a5, both.
Or rook d1. Rook d1 is winning a pawn, I think.
Rook d1 and rook a1, yeah?
Yeah, because on c3, rook c1 and rook c2 and still wins the pawn.
Yeah, I just like bringing my king in, you know, and just...
Yeah, you have to.
Yeah, king c5 has been played, king e1, king c4, or king b4. Even the king and pawn ending, like king b4, rook d2, you can just take and play king a3. That's just really simple. Yeah, king b4 played, rook e3. Okay, so he's cutting the king for the moment. Now just
what the...
b5.
One more question for us.
Yes.
What other sport helps you be a better chess player?
I don't know, just being active in general is really important, I would say. You know, whether it's dancing or sports or specific gym work, all the top players are pretty much in good shape, eating well. I know that from experience, having worked with Fabiano for some years. And that's a vital part of the regime. So, yeah, just keep healthy. Healthy mind, healthy body. Really simple as that.
That's right.
Okay,
that's
this
right.
Is,
I think swimming is a very good one.
Swimming is also, yeah. Just B5.
Mountain climbing, yeah. People are saying this. Mountain climbing is a great thing. You're getting out, fresh air. You see a lot of beautiful stuff. Keep your body in a good shape and your mind, you clear your mind. Sorry, Lawrence, I interrupted you.
Yes.
Want to say something
no,
about
no, no.
This game?
I was going to say, well, this should still be fairly good for black. I don't know if easily winning. I think here I'd play the move c5 with the idea of rook h4 to block with rook d4 and then play b4 and try and create an outside pass pawn. Rook d4, first of all, is also good as rook h6 can just be met by c5. And notice how this king... It's cut off, can't join the action. That's it. This rook is a gorgeous rook. Now, if I were black, I would just go c5. Just advance your pawns, go b4. And if he takes, I could take with a c-pawn. Yeah, also a4, c5, b4 is the same idea.
Yeah.
White's just got no way to combat this. This is fairly trivial, actually.
Yeah.
Just go
too
c5.
Easy.
Yeah, it's c5 and b4 is coming.
White is playing without a rook. Without a king. If the king was on b2, that would be a draw, but
yes.
With the king there.
Bad king. King's very important.
Yes.
So quick round up the results. Snowballs win 11-5. The Towers are going to win probably by a few more, depending on the results. The Cannes Blockbusters just sneaked it in game or match of this week against the Dublin Desperadoes, 8.5, 7.5.
Despite the heroic efforts by the former world champion.
Yeah, wasn't quite enough. The Puffins beat the Abuja Rockstars. The Marseille Migraines crush Amsterdam, and the Apeldoorn Apes give Hamburg a good old beating as well. So I imagine Stop Trying Hard is actually going to resign here because, well, he's going to play on, but even just King C3 now is just completely over. The king can get to B2, win this guy, like King C3. If Rook B8, then you can just go B4. Yeah. This is just massacre. Even here, just rook c4 is good enough.
Or rook d5.
Yeah, I mean, whatever. You're just winning too much material.
Keep the king away.
That's, yeah, rook d5 is a much better move. Yep.
That's a good thing to do. And also, white is up, is down to 12 seconds, which is not great for him. I would have gone b4 here, to be honest with
c4
you.
C4 was fine. I mean, you're just winning this pawn.
Doesn't really matter. He wants to take them for free, all of them.
Yeah, once you win all three, it really is an easy job. And only one other game going on, but really irrelevant. King b3, c3, whatever.
There is Bivark against chess trainer.
Yeah.
FM chess trainer.
Yeah, and black is just completely winning.
So perhaps it's time to wrap up the show.
I think
this
so.
Game is over.
Yeah.
Before you go ahead, I would like to award the...
Please do, yeah.
The 1 month Diamond membership to our loyal viewer here, Scooby Dude. Although I know there were a lot of other people who deserved it. But I think that he was asking the most reasonable questions, and he was quite active. So Scooby Dude, I hope that you will enjoy it. Guys, those of you who didn't make it, next time, next show, also remember, we are giving away free memberships for 1 month. Be active. Give us our questions. Ask the questions.
Yeah. Be active in the chat, ladies and gentlemen. There is still one more game. We'll stay with it just for the remaining seconds. But this is a pretty simple win. Bishop d3, followed by king g2 and h2. King g2 now, bishop e4 and king g2. King g2 and h2, and it's time to resign if you are white. Nothing to be done here at all. So, hope everybody has enjoyed the commentary this week. This is not the end of the Pro Chess League for today. Remember, we're covering all divisions, and next will be the East Coast division of the USA, which will follow immediately after this broadcast. So it's late here. It's nearly midnight. So I hope you've had a great time. From me, Laurence Trent, and Grandmaster Dejan Boykov, we're going to hand it over to our next team of commentators, and we look forward to seeing you next week for week four of the Central Division of the Pro Chess League.
Thank you guys for being here. It's been a pleasure, Laurence. Nice to work with you, as usual. A lot of fun.
It was good fun.
I hope you enjoyed it too.
Brilliant. Yes. Okay, and guys.
That will be everything for today.
All right. See you later. Bye now.
See you. Bye.